What's going on, goats? Welcome back to Buku Bucks. My name is Ramo, and today is going to be day 3 of the ICT speedrun. Before we get started, let's go over day 2 notes. So we do have a lot more notes today, so bear with me as I try to get through it all. Day 2, elements of a trade setup. Build context or framework for your trades. There are 4 things price can do: expansion, retracement, reversal, or consolidation. There are 4 reference points in institutional order flow: order blocks, fair value gaps and liquidity voids, liquidity pulls and stop runs, and equilibrium. Interbank price delivery algorithm. The artificial intelligence price engine designed to manipulate the market. You can use clues or fingerprints to figure out what it will do next. All markets start in consolidation and move into an expansion. After that, it will either go back into consolidation, a retracement, or reversal. If price gets to a retracement or reversal, it will go back into an expansion. Expansion. Impulse move from a level of equilibrium. Indicates a willingness on the part of the market makers to reveal their intended repricing model. Look for price to return to the order block left near or at equilibrium. Retracement. When price moves back inside the recently created price range, this indicates a willingness to reprice to levels not efficiently traded for fair value. Can be referred to as liquidity gaps and liquidity voids. Usually, they are created with a quick movement in price in one direction. Reversal. When price moves the opposite direction that current direction has taken it, indicates price has ran a level of stops and a significant move should unfold in the new direction. Look for the liquidity pulls just above or below an old high or low. Consolidation. When price moves inside a clear trading range and shows no willingness to move higher or lower, it indicates the market makers are allowing orders to build on both sides. Expect a new expansion near term. Look for the impulse wing in price away from the equilibrium price level that is found at the halfway point of the range. Use the candle, not the wicks, when using the fib. How market makers condition the market. Retail traders are collectively part of a large group of traders known as uninformed money or dumb money, or also known as willing and or unwilling liquidity. Smart money is a small group, but it is the entity that actually moves the market's liquidity provider. The goal is to understand how the banks slash smart money move the market so we can tag along with them. Expansion equals Judah swing, retracement equals New York session, reversal equals London swing, consolidation equals Asian range. Daily range structure, and this is in chronological order as well. Price equilibrium, manipulation, expansion, reversal, retracement, and then consolidation. Here I took ICT's exact words to give a better understanding on what he is trying to tell us with these specific words with the daily range structure. Price starts with equilibrium, Asian range. Then there is a manipulation slash Judah swing. Always comes by some news event at the time of the manipulation or just before. Then we will see an expansion. It will go down or up into 5 a.m. Between 5 a.m. and 8 a.m., the market will go back into consolidation. Then it will have a retracement between 8 to 8:30 a.m., then either a reversal or expansion going into 10 to 11 a.m., where it will have a reversal, London close. Then the market will go into consolidation, ending true day. Also keep in mind that all of these times are New York EST time. The market cannot go from consolidation to retracement or reversal. Expansion must come before. What to focus on right now. Uninformed money believe that price moves by indicators. Get rid of this idea. Smart money has the unique perspective of understanding already what the uninformed money is going to believe about the marketplace, and that gives them their edge. Understanding comes from exposure, and exposure creates experience. Delete all previous knowledge moving forward. What you should be focused on right now. Creating daily price action logs with price charts. Daily chart, 12 months worth. 4-hour chart, 3 months worth. 60-minute chart, 3 weeks worth. 15-minute chart, 3 to 4 days worth. Resist the urge to forecast price movements right now. Do note where price shown a quick movement from a specific level. Do note recent highs and recent lows that haven't been retested. Do note areas on the charts where price has left clean highs or lows. Do note what day's weekly highs and lows form and what kill zone it formed in. Do note the daily high and daily low every trading day and what kill zone it formed in. Equilibrium versus discount. OTE, optimal trade entry, is the idea of looking at swing projections, retracements, and identifying what would be deemed as optimal trade entry. To be a buyer, or at least have the idea of participating in the market as a buyer, there has to be a willingness of somebody with bigger pockets than you, and they are the ones that move price around, and they are the banks. Vice versa for a seller. Use the Fib tool from and to major swing points to establish equilibrium. You can use the largest range or the present market range. Spot the impulsive moves. When you see an impulsive move, this is an indication of displacement. Displacement is where someone with a lot of money comes into the marketplace and they have a strong conviction to move price higher or lower. Equilibrium is a midway point of a price move, 50% on the Fib. A swing high is when you have a shorter candle to the left and a shorter candle to the right, three candle pattern. When you see the fourth bearish candle, you can expect price to retrace back to equilibrium. You want to see this candle move or be lower than the candle that made the swing high. When in a bullish market, you want to buy at equilibrium or discount. Discount is the area underneath the 50%. Sometimes price will run through your Fib and that is okay. It happens. OTE will be the area between the 62% and the 79%. Smart money will distribute long positions above old highs. It doesn't have to be the oldest high, so don't be greedy with your take profits. With Forex, the markets move in intraday price action in grades of 10 and 20 pip ranges above a high or low to reach for stops. Equilibrium versus premium. Same as the previous section, just flipped. If you are looking for short opportunities, you should short in premium. If price does not pull back into premium, there is nothing to do or no trade. You can short at the 50%/equilibrium, but it is best to allow price to drive higher into premium to look for higher probability shorts. There will be times you are attempting to short in premium, but price drives deeper into premium, stopping you out before going lower. This will happen. Fair valuation. Fair value comes into two perspectives. Fair value in regards to equal distance of a higher low, equilibrium, or in regards to market makers. In relation to the image below, when price is in discount, we can anticipate price to go higher because the market is looking to create fair value by going to premium, and the market makers are looking to create fair value to short in premium while also filling liquidity voids. Buying in premium or selling a discount is not fair value. It would be the opposite. When a liquidity void is created, there is a willingness for price to come back into these areas. Price does not always have to do it immediately. If price is going to reverse from an old higher low, price should not consolidate. Liquidity runs. Liquidity refers to the degree to which a market can be quickly bought or sold in the market without affecting the asset's price. In other words, where the buy stops and sell stops are located. When you see a swing high, short traders are placing their stops above this key area. Therefore, buy stops are above. When you see a swing low, long traders are placing their stops below this key area. Therefore, sell stops are below. High resistance liquidity runs. The market has a tendency to run out old highs and lows, but has a very difficult time to do that when the market has conditions where there are a lot of peaks. In the example below, where price is currently at, if it wants to get above the swing high, it has to encounter a lot of resistance in the form of old highs and old lows. The lows act as standard resistance and the highs act as buy stop liquidity. When we trade, we are not looking for these opportunities. Same thing but flipped for the bullish scenario. If price wants to get below the swing low, it has to encounter a lot of resistance in the form of old highs and lows. Low resistance liquidity runs. If there is a very sharp or one-way type of direction, very little retracements of any kind on the way down, this is low resistance liquidity. You can expect price to return up into the last low that was broken. You can expect internal highs to get ran through until the last low that was broken is touched. These highs are low resistance liquidity areas. Once price gets back to the low, anything above that will be high resistance liquidity. Same thing but flipped for the bullish scenario. You can expect price to retrace down to the last high that was broken. All lows before then are low resistance liquidity areas. Impulse price swings and market protraction. Impulse price swings are clean, sharp movements in price. Time-sensitive impulse swings are market protraction or manipulation. There are three primary protractionary market moves every day. 8 p.m. EST, a movement up or down immediately and usually reverses. 12 a.m. EST, first move is designed to fake out the individuals that chase that initial move. 7 a.m. EST, retracement of London's move, also a manipulation move. You can use these ranges with the Fib to plot premium and discount. So to even simplify this one even more, usually at these specific times, price gives a fake out move or a manipulation. So with that being said, that is all of the notes for day two. Let's go ahead and jump into day three. So for day three, we will be going over core content month two, all parts. I didn't show last video, but if you guys do want to see exactly where I am pulling these videos from, scroll down to about page 25 and you can see here, this is where month two starts. But without further ado, let's go ahead and jump into the videos.
Well, my focus is month two of the active mentorship. This is teaching 108 of the second month of 12. And we're dealing specifically with growing small accounts without high risk. Now, before we start, obviously, you know what it is we need to avoid. The first thing you need to do is do not try to rush to make massive gains, either pips or returns. I can tell you, I fell victim to this as a new trader. I went in thinking I'd get rich really, really quick. As a trader, after I started seeing how fast profits can come, it kind of makes you think that it's like a lottery, every time you sit in your future, and it's not the case. Okay, so as a new trader, the first thing you want to do is kind of suppress that desire to try to chase massive gains, and it's either in a total number of pips, it seems like it's a trophy thing to tell that on your network or form, or mediums like Twitter or Instagram, or Facebook. It's not important how many pips you have, it's not important how much money you make. It's percent returns to actually make consistent wealth building, and don't chase high percentages. You don't even really need high percentages to build wealth. Do not open yourself to large risk in hopes of equally large returns for profits. It's not necessary. We have very much risk when you trade to make a lot of money. It's rather myopic and a misnomer for new traders when they come into this industry. They think they have a lot of money and they have to go light risk to make money. Well, that's not true. And the only reason why they think that is because they're trying to make money quick, lots of money real quick. You are assuming taking small risks and fine trades will not grow your account. This is one of the lessons that took a while for me to learn early in my career. I thought I had to have a lot of risk in trades, and otherwise, what's my account grow? And that's not true. Once I understood the compound interest factor, it doesn't take much time at all for your money to grow. It doesn't matter how much you start with. You can start on a shoestring budget, even as little as $100. $100 can grow exponentially over time if you submit to it. And now, if everyone would start with $100, number one, you'd never be broke if you made mistakes initially. Secondly, who says you can't add more money to it once you become more confident? See, that's the part everyone jumps ahead. Everyone take everything they're willing to risk and lose, but not really lose it. And they put in their account, and they could all want to trade and hopefully get a lot of money. You don't need to do that. You don't need to do that at all. You have to find your trades with a very, very low risk in terms of total equity, and then watch the compound over time. That's how you grow an account. Do not sacrifice trading equity for core planning or lack thereof. As I just mentioned in point number three, it's very important to understand that there is not a necessity for large risk to build wealth. You need to have consistent parameters that will allow you good risk models for each trade with well-defined low-risk parameters. The setups need to have well-defined risk, 2% ideally if you're a new trader, but no more than 2% on average. You don't need to have any more risk than that to build wealth. What do you need to aim for? What specific things should you be focusing on going forward? How small can house start building up? Well, you need to determine how realistically you can anticipate a favorable reward risk model. What does it look like? We're talking about that in this specific teaching. You have to learn to respect the risk side of the trade setups more over the reward. So many times, and I did this during the trade, we don't think about losing money, because we're always right. The fact that we think about the profits solely and don't really concern ourselves with respect to that, we could lose on every single trade. How many times have you started a trade as a new trader? Now you're nervous when you first had it. When you first put the trade on, greed puts you into that trade. Greed puts you into that position where you're trying to make money. But once that transaction starts and you're in your marketplace, that greed transfers into fear. I hope I make money. What if I don't make money? See, when you first put the trade on, we're not necessarily fearful, unless we're fearful of missing a move. It's greed that puts you into the trade as a new trader. But you need to learn to respect the risk side before you take that trade and execute on it. Because if you don't focus on that side, that's the part that hurts you. Nobody gets broke by taking profits. They all go broke by taking too much risk. Identify trade setups that permit three reward multiples to one risk or higher. It's very important. We're talking about specific numbers and how it's actually measurable in terms of odds. But you want to look for trade setups that have 3-1 payoffs. For every $1 risking, you hope to make $3. Train good reward risk setups that have little impact if unprofitable. Again, it gets back to having very small risk. If you have very small risk, well-defined trade setups, you're never going to worry about, well, you might get a loser here, you might get losses, but it's not going to take you out of business. It's not going to take you out of your career or choice. You can't lose any money. You obviously change the course of your life in terms of financial fluency. And even if you're not trying to get rich, if you're just trying to have passive income, and you're trying to supplement some of your bills, your monthly cost of living, you can't get a monetary desire. So keep that in mind. You want to do this for a long time, not just get lucky for a short period of time and make a lot of money. No one does it. Forex is not the lottery.
So for this one, I basically agree with all of it. I definitely agree that you do not need to rush to make massive gains in either pips or percent returns. Think about it this way. Even if you do make 1% a day, that is 5% a week, that is 20% a month, which can obviously be very beneficial or just even be very profitable. Even though it seems so minute that you're only making 1% a day, as time goes on, obviously that is going to compound and make a big difference. So remember, you don't need to risk more. You don't need to try to shoot for bigger returns. Small risk over a period of time can definitely be beneficial. Also, Let's see. With the risk reward model, I do agree with the idea of trying to set up a minimum of a 1-3 risk reward setup. I know some people do 1-1s, 1-2s. I'm not saying you can't do that, but ideally, for me personally, 1-3 is probably this happy medium. Also, the higher you're able to get your risk reward to be, the little impact that it has if you actually take a loss. I won't break it down right now, but if your risk reward is a lot higher than say 1-1, 1-2, you can actually lose more, but actually still be a profitable trader. So once again, don't try to rush anything. Don't try to catch a home run in one trade. Keep your composure, keep your trade plan, and trade little by little, and things compound over time. And try to have a risk reward model that is going to be at least a 1-3.
The cost of living. You know, you came here with a monetary desire, so keep that in mind. You want to do this for a long time, not just get lucky for, you know, short period of time and get a lot of money. That doesn't happen. No one does that. Forex is not the lottery. All right, the reality of reward to risk ratios. Okay, what will you need to see in performance or profitability? Now, everyone thinks they don't never have a loss. When you first start out, everyone's Superman, they can't go wrong. Your system's going to be the best thing since sliced bread. Don't worry about it. You'll never have a loser kid. No one starts in this industry with that as a hit around running, never having losing trades. You're running counter that. So
it looks like here he'll actually break down the percent win rate that you need to be profitable or have the minimum ratio to at least break even. So he'll break it down more here.
About accuracy. Accuracy is not even necessary in terms of high accuracy to make money. You don't need high accuracy to get wealth, but you do need time. Time is the missing element. That's the secret. That's the holy grail to allow compound interest to do its magic. So my question to you is this. Do you think your 75% win rate here? In other words, every trade you get in is 75% of the trades winners. If that's the case, your win at 75%, that is actually very high. And your ratio in terms of what you're hoping to make in terms of your risk, it's really low. You don't need to have very much in terms of risk to make $1. If you hit 60%, you have even still, you have less in terms of what you have to take on as risk to make $1. But when you get to 50-50, you have to risk $1 for $1. Then at 40%, the ideal ratio would be you're trying to make $1.50 for every $1. To be profitable, you're only 30% accurate. Ideally, the minimum is you only look for trades that you $2 for every $1 risk. That's 25% accuracy. Think about this. If 75% of the trades that you take are losing trades, the minimum ratio for profitability is you have to look for trades that you have $3.1. Now, think about this for a moment. If we look at the low end objective in terms of accuracy, and 25% accurate, we're looking for trades that are paying out, hopefully, $3 reward for $1 risk. So if we have that scenario, and we are able to take a trade and make $1 and make $3 in return, we can be wrong 75% of the time and still be net profitable. Now think about that. If you grow your understanding of the thing I'm teaching you, say you become profitable to the degree where half of your trades are profitable. That means the ability for you to find 3-1 trades.
So here, if you didn't catch it, if you are taking a minimum ratio or a minimum risk reward setup of a 1-3, you can be 25% accurate and be a break-even trader. Meaning, if you are 30% accurate, meaning you only win 30% of your trades, you can still be a profitable trader. So I know sometimes it may seem like, well, I lose 60% of the time, I'm a terrible trader, I can never be profitable. But if you have the right risk reward, it is most definitely possible. If you have a 75% win rate, you'll really only need less than a 1-1, you only need a 0.3-1. Obviously, that is kind of silly to do, but the idea is the higher your risk reward ratio is, the less accurate you have to be. And the higher your win rate is, the lower your minimum ratio will be as well.
More than doubles. More than doubles. So that means your accuracy grows, but your reward to risk ratio, if it just stays 3-1, you're going to have more trades.
So this book called Six Sigma Stretch is designed to keep you in one trade. So it's not the assumption
that they got 3-1. Therefore, your accuracy will increase exponentially. And what happens when your win rate goes above 50%? What happens if you have a 65-70% accuracy and you're looking still for 3-1 trades? Your money grows exponentially. What happens when you start looking for reward to risk ratios of $5 payout for $1 risk and you have a 70% accuracy? Suddenly, wealth is not that far out of reach. Now, looking at an example of trading with statistics behind it, I think everyone would agree that to make a percentage increase of 50% inside 1 month is actually a pretty good feat. Now, I'm not advocating that everyone's going to be able to make 50% in 1 month. It's not going to happen. If you have an account that would be relatively small, and I'm going to say for the benefit of example, we're going to say $5,000 is something that everyone's able to do. Once they have a trade, we're going to say everyone is willing to put $5,000 into a trading account, and you'll turn around and you'll have no trade in your account, and you'll use some ideas we teach here, and you're going to find big payouts, big reward to risk ratio trade setups. To make a 50% return on your account in 1 month, it doesn't take many trades to do that, but it does take highly selective setups, and you have to do certain things to make this pay out. And here's the thing, once you get one or two of them in your month in terms of trades, you can now start lowering your risk reward ratio trade setups. If you want to stay busy, you can still do very well adding more percentage-wise on your account, but you don't go out there every single time looking for big payout trades. You can get regular scenarios with 2-1, 3-1 scenarios where it's easy to payouts. So if you start $5,000 and you're able to find stuff to do these things, and that's what I did in my expert membership, I showed a 50% return, and it didn't mean trade at all, it wasn't trade at all, it actually brought this type of return. The profit actually grows over $2,500, and that's not bad for an account to start $5,000, not a lot of trading in the first month. That is what is.
So here he's showing a couple of examples where he actually had over 50% return. Yes, all of us will not be able to do that, especially the first time around. It is not needed, but it's definitely possible to do, is what he's trying to show us.
Possible, but not a standard. You don't expect this adding more every single month, I think. But think about this. If you show a 50% return just for the year, how amazing would that be if you were able to take your money and compound it where you had a return of 50% per year? That blows away every money manager's goal out there. It's a certain level of stock return, you know, IRA, like that. It would be out from every asset class available to you. And think about what you're able to do. You do that in a month. You do that in 1 month, you're high payout, low risk. Imagine what's available to you. This is the one you want to pay the most attention to, because you have to respect this side of it, because the drawdown is what will hurt you and it will hurt you monetarily. So, you see, what our goal is to have little to no drawdown. Now, you don't have drawdown. This camp will have drawdown, you will see it. It's not my goal to show you massive drawdown, so you can see how it comes back from it. The idea of the membership is a large drawdown. Now, obviously, 1 month, take 10 trades. I tell you my average goal for the week is 55 a week, and you see here the average win is 51.80 dips. And with 10 trades, that's a call of 518 dips for the month, and I think that's pretty consistent for what I'm able to do on a month-to-month basis. I'll try to do anything more than this. This is like my sweet spot for my performance, and I'm trying to do anything about this. Every time I try to do that, I get confident in the new app, 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 I get confident in the That's right, 6%. 6% what? 6% equity compounding per month. Now that sounds much. That sounds sexy. It doesn't give you the wins. Well, guess what? It only takes 20 tips before you do it. It only requires 1.5% risk. It only requires 1-to-1 ratio to do it. That means if you find a trade that pays out 20 tips, and you frame the trade where you only take 20 tips risk, guess what? That's all that's necessary, and they happen every single day. Now, I'm not advocating looking for 1-1 ratio trades, but I'm going to show you by example how easy it is to get that. Once your accuracy increases and you understand price action, these setups are there every single trade. Now, again, I'm not trying to instill an action warrior hero where you're going and trying to prove the world you can trade every single day. You're trying to do every single day. I don't think it's something that can be done consistently every single day. And if you do, you're inviting losses, and there isn't a.
So I think this is actually a really reasonable percentage to go for, 6% a month. That's obviously less than 2% a week. You can easily make 1% in a day. So if you have 2 winning days in a week, that is very reasonable. As you kind of talked about it too, sometimes you do need to be a bit more selective with your trade setups, or if you're looking for those bigger plays, you definitely will have to be a bit more selective, and that is very doable.
Trading day, it doesn't look good initially in those hour quickly. You want to trade in highly selective conditions. And when you do that, even with low reward to risk ratios, 1-to-1, you can still find 1.5% return payouts per week. One trade that's all you need, and you're actually going to have 1.6%. But what does 6% do compound every single month? It doubles your money every single year. I don't care what trade size is you start with. Now, $10,000, your risk for trade is only 1.5% or $15. That's it. You only risk $15. Now, if you lost $15 in your $1,000 account, are you going to go home and take it out on your family? No, most people wouldn't do that. And if you would, then you're probably not meant for trade. So, what you'd be risking is 20 tips for your entry price. And you're probably taking 20 tips for 1.5% return. But here's the thing, it's easy to say this in number form, but how do you find it? Where do these setups occur? Well, the 6% per month sales, they form specifically, and the easy ones to find are looking at your daily chart. They make it easy to do. What is it specifically you're looking for? Well, you're looking for the things I talked about in the very first month of this mentorship. One specific is order block. Where is the price point at which a move quickly moves away from a level? If it indicates it's moving up, we find that down candle right before the move goes higher. When price goes back down to that down candle, we have a really good probability just off of the daily chart that you're going to get 20 tips or more pricing. Now, magnified and zoomed in, we can see that order block is noted in two areas. We're looking at the buy of the candle, which is the opening of the down candle, up to the high of that candle. Okay, that's a fair value gap. Price you can see, trade right back down into that level right here. If price hits that on that particular day, that's when you'd be looking for a trade. You can go long there. Okay, but not just because it hits that level. We're going to wait for something to give confirmation. Obviously, the same thing occurs. When more time frame, we look for the order block. We're going to scale down because everything price is fractal. So we're highlighting specifically the 0.7512 level.
So here we have not gone over order blocks or exactly how to identify them. I'm not sure if he will break that down from a very beginner level. But here he's showing this as an order block, as this is a down move that produced this big bullish up move. So he's marking up the down move here where price opened and basically where price began to reverse with the opening of price, went down and then went bullish. So this is the daily bullish order block that he is utilizing to take longs from. He also did point out where he did not draw a fair value gap, but he's also pointing out now there's a fair value gap from this first candlestick wick high up to this third candlestick wick low right here. So price is also filling that fair value gap.
We're going to scale down because everything price is fractal. So we're highlighting specifically the 0.7512 level. Okay, so we have a one-hour chart. We're zoomed in and you see price shows an old low right here. And below low is going to be sell-stop below there. And the price drives down below that, taking out an area of sell-stop where we're going to fill liquidity. But it goes specifically down into that one level we identified on the chart, being 0.7512. Price straight down into that level and slams right into it. Now we are in turtle soup conditions. That means a break below low, we could potentially expect this market to run higher. When it hits this level, when our chart, we can simply wait. We're going to wait for confirmation that the market wants to go higher from that level. In other words, we're going to see if the bank sponsors that level. If they do, we already know by looking at what we learned in the first month, there are buy stops above these EQIs. We're up here as EQIs. And when I ask you a question again, where else would you expect buy stops above the marketplace to be residing in this chart? That's right, right there. So buy stops are above us, so we can map out areas in which we can look to take our profits before we even put the trade on. That's important. You need to know where you're at in terms of risking and reward. Where you're going to take your profits, where you need the market to be drawn to, and watch the market react. So looking at 0.7512 level, that's important because we know our trading frame on the daily chart. If not finding set up, it's based on an institutional level on a daily chart. Now here we have the market trade up through the down candle right in here. That's the bullish order block. Price trade still here. Once it happens, we identify the opening and high on that candle. That's where the buy occur. Okay. So in this area, if you use the opening candle, we're going to add our 5 pips spread to it. Okay, and build that in. You can see our order would be around 0.7542. That would be our limit order. So we'd be long there. When this candle drops down into it, we would reasonably expect to see our entry be filled at that price point. Now, obviously, if we're going to be long there, the parameters for trading 6% setups, because our aim is the first year self-insane. We're trying to double money over the year, not this week, not this month. We're trying to double money over the year. That's low hanging fruit. That's easy for a new aspiring trader to grow into. It doesn't give you the control mentality. You're not trying to force $1 million into your account right away. It's gradually adding fluency. So you can find your risk by saying, okay, I'm going to take a stop at 20 pips. Okay, and that's what that does. It puts your stop in the middle of that candle. So you have a good risk model here, and also it's framing it really well because we don't want to see price go down below the middle of that candle again. It's already showing the drop below the stop. So it wants to obviously go higher. If it's going to go higher, it won't come back down below the middle of that candle or bullish order block. So our stop is 75.2. Our entry is 75.2. 20 pips stop loss. And obviously, as soon as we get this level here, we're already at 1.1. So at this point, we could be long here. Right here, we're already at, guess what, 1.5% profit. Now, once we get 1.5% profit, does that mean we can last trade? We can. Absolutely, we can. That's a 1-1 here, and you make our 1.5% return, and it's that quick over. In a couple hours, you're done for the week. But what did we first start to trade with? We framed it with a buy stop up here and buy stop up here. So when price goes our first profit, we can start taking our risk and reducing it, taking some of it off. In fact, we could probably do this. We could take half the position off, and guess what we'll do? We'll make 0.75% return on the trade. Once it gets to this level here, we're at first objective. So now we're going to 0.75.
So before he continues, a couple of things I want to point out that I kind of have concerns about or potential questions. I understand that price tapped his daily bullish order block here, so that's why he was looking for longs. My first thing is, why or how do I know to use the daily order block from this specific time frame? Because, for example, if I go to a different time frame, such as the 2-day or the 8-hour, the 4-hour, whatever time frame it is, this specific order block is going to be slightly different. He is using this specific line like this because this is the opening of the candle on this specific time frame. But on a different time frame, the opening might be up here and might be lower. So I bring this up because in this example, he is looking for longs here because price tapped into the daily order block. But hypothetically, if you use a different opening of the candle, you might have a line up here. So then how come we weren't buying here as price began to kind of push higher, but instead decided to buy down here? For now, I'll just say that he is strictly using the daily order blocks. So in this case, he's using the opening candle of the order block. So therefore, he wasn't looking for longs here. He was looking for longs here once price actually tapped into the order block. Also, we can see here price took out these this liquidity where there are sell stops resting underneath. Once again, why not buy when price took out the low? Why do we have to wait for price to also take out this low and this low? Why aren't we looking for longs off of here? Once again, I'll just leave it up to the fact that price did not tap into the daily order block. I also did note that once price... Here, the best way to see world for anyone is 1835. Into that one. Sorry about that. When price pushed on up from here, let's go ahead and show it. We haven't gone over it just yet, but there could be some type of break of structure, market structure shift, change of character, whatever you want to call it. But price shows the willingness to go higher. I do find it interesting that when we do potentially look for longs here, let me pull it up here. He's actually putting a stop loss underneath this last down candle. He's not putting it underneath this wick low. Me personally, the way I usually do it, I will use a fit from low to high. Want to see price come down the discount. And the stop loss should be underneath this swing low. Because technically, price can push back down into the OTE or even below the OTE, still respect this low before pushing on higher. So something to take note of. Maybe in situations like this, if price is truly going to go higher, there isn't a need for a stop loss underneath the low. So maybe I might need to reevaluate or study this specific price movement to help me understand when it is suitable to place a stop higher up here rather than underneath the low. I'm curious to know if he did plot up what exactly this blue line or blue rectangle was here.
To buy stops are above us, so we can map out areas in which we can look to take our profits before we even put the trade on. That's important. You need to know where you're at in terms of risking and reward, where you're going to take your profits, where you need the market to be drawn to, and watch the market react. So looking at 0.7512 level, that's important because we know our trading frame of the daily chart. It's not finance setup, it's based on an institutional level on a daily chart. Now here we have the market trade up through the down candle right in here. That's the bullish order block. Price trades through here. Once it happens, we identify the opening and high on that candle. That's where the buy would occur. Okay? So in this area, we use the opening on that candle. We're going to add our 5 pips spread to it. Okay, build that in. And you see our order would be around 0.7542. That would be our limit order. So we'd be long there.
So here he's talking about he would long here. I'm not sure exactly what he would call this. I probably would call it some form of a breaker block. But here he's just plotting up the wicks of this last down move here. But he doesn't really explain exactly what that is, but he's looking for longs in this area.
Area we use the opening candle, we're gonna add our 5 pips spread to it, okay, and build that in. You can see our order would be, now obviously if we're gonna be long there, the parameters for trading 6% setups, so let's see. So you're gonna know that down candle or bullish order, 5% return on the trade. Once it gets to this level here, we're up here as first objective. So now we're going to 0.754 3/4%. And we're allowing the price to scan up to another level. So now guess what, as soon as we get this level here, we're back 1.5%. We make another profit objective here at multiple 2. So now we're 1.5% again, but we've already banked 3/4%. Now mind you, 1.5% open profit is taken, so it hasn't been realized yet. But have we reached the buy stop yet? No, we have not seen anything in terms of these buy stops that are here being reached into our sweat. Guess what happens? Multiple 3 comes in here. Now we've added another 20 pips of profit and clear the stops. We can take another portion of our position off. We can take a quarter of it off. We can take a half of it off. Whatever it is that you want to do, I'm not giving you any structure yet, but I want you to think about paying yourself right here. Okay? You would have done well over what was necessary to make 1.5% return. And you graduated your exits based on last 4 years of price reach. At this point here, after your second multiple reach, your stop needs to be break even. So you'd be down here at your entry. So now you have right now no way for that to take you out below your entry point. Okay? And you already bank the position that you scale out some. And obviously multiple 4 is hit, gets real close to where our buy stops are, so we reasonably expect this to do what? Maybe consolidate, maybe trace.
So right here, he's not giving us an exact plan or rule-based system on how we should take profits, but he's just showing some potential examples on what we could do, whether we want to collapse the entire position at a 101, whether we want to hold because price hasn't really taken out any buy side liquidity up into these 1-3s, 1-4 areas, or potentially we can partial and take some profits on the way to the upside.
Trace a little bit, but still reach for another area of liquidity above these equals over here. And ultimately get multiple 5, it clears out the buy side over here. And guess what? I'll leave you to study this in terms of how many opportunities you've done in terms of scaling if you would have took off half the multiple of 1. In order to need 20 pips, you take half it off, and you let the remaining half run all the way up to get these stops. How much money would that be? How much percent would that be? What would that do for your account? What if you took off 1/4 of here at 20% and let the remaining balance run? What if you took off 3/4 of it off here and let 1/4 of the position run? All of these things are for your study, and it's important to do this because I want you to think about what is available to you. This is only one setup frame on a daily chart, and it was aiming for what? Buy stops we've already identified. Those buy stops were reached into right there. Everything that was shown to you in month 1 was used here in an illustrative purpose. So now you can see how easy it is to get that 1.5% return a week, and you only get in the full shot where you get in and you get out, all full in, all full out, in terms of entry and exit, full position on, full position off. You can graduate your position profits and scale them out logical levels and still allow your little bit of portion of the position to pay out amazingly. Think about this. Let's say you took off the position here. Okay? So you have 0.75 or 3/4%. So now here you got 3/4% and 1.5%. Here's 3% return just on the second half. Now think about that. You make 3.5% on the second half plus 3/4%. 0/4%. Just in that trade, you're graduating it and just scaling out. Now what do you do that every single week? Now have this. What do you do it twice a week? What happens if you do it 3 times a week? How much does your money grow if you trade like this? Everything is organized. Everything is specifically designed. You only execute with one specific task in mind. You buy at specific levels. You sell at specific levels. You trade your stock only when specific levels are reached for. We do all these things. But think about this. This is a 5-1 stop. This is what a one-shot, one kill looks like. And it's framed on a daily low. It's going to give you institutional sponsorship. There should be a willingness to see price rally on here. Why? Because of the daily low. The banks trade off the daily levels. So if you enjoy this teaching, the next two will be actually giving you more detail about trade ideas and scenarios like this, so we can, you know, build your understanding back.
So he kind of said it, banks trade off of daily levels. So I think that's why he was patiently waiting for price to hit that daily order block instead.
Build your equity and grow from even a small account. And again, we start with $1,000. Okay, $1,000 becomes over $2,000 after 12 months. And there's some people think that's great. But guess what? That's 10 years. It's over $1 million. And my question is, where?
One thing I will add to this, it's definitely not always a bad idea to take profits or collapse your position sooner than later. I would just let you guys know to be very mindful of when you guys do take partials. If you do hit a 1 to 5 RR trade and you're partialing all the way up to the 1 to 5, at the end of it, you're not going to come out with a 1 to 5 RR profit. Meaning if you risk $1 and you hit a 1 to 5, if you took partials on the way up, you're not going to gain $5 at the end of it. You're going to gain something less than that depending on how much you partialed on the way up. So just be very aware, if you're always looking for 1 to 3s, 1 to 5 RRs, but you're partialing all the way to the upside, technically you really aren't hitting a 1 to 3, 1 to 5, and that could potentially mess up your risk to reward plan that you have set for yourself.
Where are you going to be 10 years from now? If you have $1,000 right now, will you have $1 million years from now? You got no excuse not to now. Until next time, wish you good luck and good trade. Welcome back. This is module 2 of month 2 of the ICT mentorship. We're going to be specifically teaching on how to frame low-risk trade setups. Now, before we actually consider doing this, we have to consider what makes a setup worth taking. And ideally, selecting trade setups on higher time frame charts is ideal. That's the primary function of a high odds probability trade. You have to look at a higher time frame chart to give you the directional bias, to give you the institutional overflow, the support resistance idea that would be framing the buy or sell idea you're looking to do. And the reason why we do that is because large institutions and banks analyze markets on daily, weekly, and monthly basis. And when we do these things, we're locating price levels that align with institutional order flow. This is key because if you don't have the institutional order flow on a monthly, weekly, and daily time frame, it's going to limit your exposure to high probability setups. High time frame setups form slow and provide ample time to plan accordingly. Folks that can't day trade, folks that can't be inside of the short-term intervals in terms of charts, they have businesses, they have jobs, they have life, you know, barriers to keep them from being able to be an intraday trader. You don't necessarily need to be a day trader. You can be using these high time frame charts and they'll be able to frame out really low-risk, high-end probability setups. It doesn't require being intraday. What can we do to lower the risk in trade? A higher time frame has more influence on price, so we focus there. The conditions that lend to a trade setup on a higher time frame can be refined to a lower time frame. Transposing the higher time frame levels to lower time frame charts is important because that way we can start to reduce the overall exposure in terms of pips for our stops. And finally, refining higher time frame levels to lower time frame charts allow for smaller stop loss placement and, by default, lower risk. Levels to lower time frame charts.
Right here, what makes a setup worth taking? Trade setups on a higher time frame chart is ideal. The reason why this is ideal is because a higher time frame has more influence on price, so we should focus on that. So I agree with that. He's also explaining how large institutions analyze markets on the daily, weekly, and monthly, so we probably should focus on that as well. And you can transpose the higher time frame levels to the lower time frame chart. So don't be afraid to use these exact same concepts on the lower time frames because the algorithm works the same way on every single time frame.
It's important that we can start to reduce the overall exposure in terms of tips for stops. And finally, refining higher time frame levels to lower time frame charts allow for smaller stop loss placement and, by default, lower risk. Okay, sticking to our model, we used the Aussie dollar daily chart last time. I'm going to look at the same setup and we'll look at it in terms of refining it with lower risk. Now, when you look at this chart here, this is exactly the same chart you saw in the previous teaching. Now, I'm going to amplify on this, but it's important to understand the way the framework is here. You're going to see it's exactly the same thing, just brought down to a lower time frame chart. We're going to do it in two scales lower. Once you look at the fact that we have the higher time frame, 75-12 level relative to the other chart, this line is here, delineating the daily bullish order block. Notice we have old low here, and price goes through that down into the higher time frame level. It's really important you see that, because not only is it just because we're going below, old low is not enough to expect a reversal. Okay, we're not looking for that, because that's the case. We're looking for higher time frame frames. Why should we expect there to be buying down low and low? Because this daily chart level, 75-12, is an old bullish order block. The banks have bought here before. So if we change that level again, okay, look at the framework here. We have an hourly chart with a low being violated down to a key support level relative to the daily time frame. We know obviously the buy stops up here, just like we did in the first teaching, and obviously the second area of buy stops. We have upper level objectives framed on this trade. It's not a scalp, it's not a day trade. It's something that's going to give us a little bit more magnitude, okay, for objectives for calling tips. Now, obviously, we framed in the first teaching in this month's delivery content. We looked at this down candle as a bullish order block, and we're looking at 75.42 as a long entry. And obviously, by doing that, we framed it with 20 pips stop. This is where our stop loss would be. Should be the limiting threshold of this down candle as a bullish order block. So, what if you want to get a small stop in relative terms to 20 pips? And here's a more important thing: what if you want to be buying lower and offering yourself a lot less in terms of risk exposure? Well, that's going to require someone to go to the time frame. Everything here, look very closely. This is very close to what you saw on an hourly chart. We have old low, price trade down below, low, right into that key level, 75-12 level. Now, this up here is the buy order that we needed on an hourly chart, way up here. But what if we focus our attention down in this area here? What do we do with this information? Well, obviously, the same thing there. We have sell stop low, low, where buy orders can be paired up on the money side. And you see the market trade down to that level, 75-12, so we do have a total sweep on setup. But we don't require price to come all up here before we start buying. So how can we do this and reduce risk? Well, we can take the bullish order block here, the down candle, right off of that level. And why is this bullish order block valuable? And it's worth taking because this candle trades through it right here. And now we can focus on the midpoint of that candle up to the high. In that area, we can be a buyer. So we can be a buyer down here, 75-20, okay, and have stop loss down here, 75-07. It should not go down to 75-07. If it's going to go higher, it should go higher from where it's at now. By doing so, now we have a 17 pip stop loss, and look how much lower we are in relative terms to what we saw on the hourly chart, way closer to this key level of 75-12, and we're using a 15-minute time frame to do it. So looking at it in terms of even further reducing the risk, we can take this small area in here, and we find that same sample size of data, okay, and we're going to take a closer look into it. Okay, so we're zooming in now on a 5-minute chart. All we're doing is on that same 75-12 level, okay, and we're refining the entry from 75-20. What can we do differently here? Well, let's take a look at what's going on inside this yellow area. Okay, we have price with another down candle as it hits that bullish order block, 75-12 on the daily chart. This down candle is violated right here, so now we can start looking at this down candle from its open or high, down to midpoint, we can be a buyer there. Or we can simply say, okay, let's basically the 75-12 level, we'll add spread to it in terms of buying. That puts it around 75-15. Our stop loss can still be down here at 75-07. That's less than 10 pips. Less than 10 pips on buy. Now you can refine this where your risk is 8 pips here, and in first profit of 8 pips above here, second and third. So you have a multiple of 3R before you even take out the buy stops above this old high 1-5 measure. Now this is not even the buy stops that was framed on an hourly chart. All we're doing is using price action on the time frame we executed on and looking at where price is going to be reaching for. So if we have a multiple of 3R, we're going to make 3 for every $1 risk. So the price has already moved 24 pips up from our entry in here. And our stop is only 8 pips below where we would enter at this old low here. Notice also, by refining our risk like this, we're actually getting multiple of 3R reward for our $1 risk. As we hit the entry that would be assumed on the hourly chart at that 975.2 level, we're hitting that level here with lower risk, and we're getting a 3-1 reward ratio. Think about that. The risk reward is $1 for $3 to be made, or in terms of reward risk. We're looking at $3 made for the $1 risk. So it's amazing how you can take this and refine that in a small time frame. You don't have to have big super wide stops, but it does require you understanding what you're doing and why you're doing it. You can't get any of these ultra short.
What ICT is trying to show us here is how the lower time frame plays a role relative to the higher time frame and how we can capitalize on understanding how this works. So going back to the daily, we understood that there was a daily order block and we anticipate price to tap into and push on higher rather than just using the daily time frame to catch this move and maybe potentially use a larger stop loss, maybe say 100, 200 pips by putting a stop loss underneath this low. What we can do is we can go down to a lower time frame and find ourselves a bullish setup to long from. And that's where we see this first example that we went over in the last video. Price gave a big push here. So then we're using this low to this high. We're anticipating this low not to get ran through. So then we can go ahead and capitalize on this move. So rather than having our stop loss be 100, 200 pips, whatever it is on the higher time frame, we are looking to long because of the higher time frame. And then since the lower time frame is giving us indication that price wants to go long as well, we are going to go down to this specific time frame. I think this is the 1 hour time frame and use this as the setup to long. Not only can we use this on the 1 hour time frame, we could potentially go down to a lower time frame. I think this is the 5 minute, this is the 15 minute, and look for longs out of here. And then he goes down to the 5 minute here that we could have potentially looked to long from. Maybe in the future, he'll explain this a tad bit more. Me personally, the way I interpret this, I really do like this specific example because we have a structure high down to low. Price gives us a higher high, giving us an indication that price has the willingness to go on higher as price has already made a new higher high. Whether you want to call it an MSS, market structure shift, chain of character, BOS, doesn't really matter. Price giving us a new high is the indication that price wants to go higher. But right here on the 5 minute time frame, you can see price doesn't really make a new high. This is all like one big swing move here. And then price gives a little intermediate pullback here or a bullish push here and then goes on higher. So me personally, this is a bit aggressive, but obviously it can work. But hopefully in the future we can help, or I personally can understand this a tad bit more on what or how to be more confident in a situation like this to take a long setup in this case. But yes, that's it for this video. Let's go ahead and watch the next one.
How triggers make 10% per month. And we're going to stick with our theme here, using our case study on the Aussie dollar. Now, quickly, obviously, going through everything we've gone through the previous two sessions, we've identified 75.12 level on the daily chart. We brought that down into a hourly chart. We noticed the supply stop above, so we know there's a 40 pools resting above. There's specific highs, so the market should be reaching up there. As much as 100 pips from the level we're identifying, 75.12, so they're easily up to 76.12. Looking at the 15-minute time frame.
I did forget to add in the other video that if you notice with the smaller time frames, you hit those 1 of 3s, 1 of 5 RRs a lot quicker. At the same time, you can still potentially hold these for longer because based on the higher time frame, we anticipate price to run these buy stops. So just because your 1 of 3, 1 of 5 RR got hit somewhere down here doesn't mean that we can't hold or still continue to long to these higher price levels.
The 15-minute time frame, as we've shown earlier in the series, we've shown there was a buy set up at 75.12 on the daily chart. We had a low. Everything that we referred to and what to focus on in September, everything's being identified in this specific case study. We don't really require the market to give us an hourly setup and use that risk. We can use the 15-minute time frame and use the framework that price gives us on that specific time frame relative to what you see on the 15-minute time frame. Obviously, the risk will be reduced from what we've seen on the hourly chart. And just as well, the 15-minute chart can be reduced down to a 5-minute chart. And we identified where the stock could be in relative terms to the bull short block. And also framed out where 3-1 reward to risk ratio would unfold. And it happened to be way below our first area of buy stops, where the 5-minute liquidity pool. Now, this is nowhere near the level of the objective we identified, just framing the trade on the hourly chart. I'm giving you context. What if we were to look at the market like this and say we traded this particular pair and we had 2% risk on the trade? If we had 2% on the trade, and the market trades up to this high where the buy stop is on the liquidity pool, the market should respond off of that 75.12 level because of the chart reference point or bull short block. If we take our 2% position and take half of that position off as we get 3-1, notice it doesn't have to blow out the buy stops here. These buy stops don't even have to get blown out. This is 3-1 reward risk. So we take first profit and bank a 1% times 3R. So we can make 3% on this one trade here and still leave the second portion of the trade one, meaning for what? The liquidity pool reference on the hourly chart. Now, as price explodes, it goes through those buy stops. Obviously, you can see going up to a 15-minute time frame. Now we can go and look at higher liquidity pools, reaching into higher and higher grade liquidity pools to get to the hourly chart. But for right now, this is what's already happened. The framework we used for 5-minute chart to that one in the second session. That model of one risk allows us to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 R. In order to be $9 every $1 risk, just reaching into the 15-minute buy stop liquidity pool. The liquidity pools we saw on the hourly chart, that's what's being identified for our objectives. But now here, we have a crossroads.
And as you can see here, he's showing the scenario where if you do hold that position and shoot for those higher time frame targets, because again, we have an idea what the higher time frame wants to do. this could turn into a really big RR play.
Can we take some position off here? Or we leave the second bounce of the original 2%, we only have 1% remaining one. We could take a portion of that off, or we can leave it to go higher and reach those higher objectives. The choice is going to be yours. Preferably, I think I would like to take something off because we're in a really nice liquidity pool relative to 15-minute time frame. And we might get some consolidation work. Could be wrong, could even reverse it. We don't ever know that. But we are trading with higher levels of institutional order relative to that daily order block from 75-12. We've seen expansion on the upside. It's now taken by stops in the form of a liquidity pool in the 5-minute chart position. Then, now we see the 15-minute liquidity pool and the buy stops over here. That's been violated. So we've already seen 9-to-1 payout, which is astonishing by any measure. And it laying the price a little bit further, much quicker to buy stop the area over here, would you reach into as well? And we have 15R as well. And this is the liquidity pool resting around that same hourly basis. I'm just doing it in terms of the 15-minute chart. You see the expansion is available to you. When you look at the market, framing it with very low risk, very low risk. Now, notice also, we took first profit at a multiple of 41. So we need $3 for our $1 risk. As soon as we did that, we already made 3% on the trade with ultra short-term risk, less than 10 pips. That was it, less than 10 pips. But let's say we framed the trade with a little bit more than that. Say we used a little more comfortable stop, say it was 20 pip stop. Could that still pay out in hands of rewards? Why wouldn't it? Obviously, the market reaches above the stops. We know the market reaches for 10 and 20 pip reads for stop sweeping. We have a little high back here. If our sales gets close to it, we can see get on to folks. The potential range of 100 pips. From where we're looking at line, and we're about to go. We don't need the absolute high, and we don't need the absolute low. We're looking at the line portion of the move about 100 pips. Let me ask you a question. Do you think you'll get every pip of every potential range identified as potential profit? If you're sitting on it, you're going to be frustrated. You don't need that. What if you just had half the range? You'll be disappointed? If you say yes, you'll be disappointed. My question is, why would you be disappointed? Is that better than doing now? In the future, it's probably going to be very easy to say, well, that would be better than doing now.
I do like that a lot. You do not have to catch the very low of the move and close out at the very high of the move. As you notice, this entire move is 100 pips. There are plenty of moves to catch within this. So don't be disappointed or mad at yourself if you don't catch this very wick low of the move and catch it all the way to the top. There's plenty of moves within it, and you do not have to catch every single pip all the time.
Very easy to say, well, that would be better than confirming. We already have 3%. And that's what I say. And straight up, let's look at the numbers. Let's look at the numbers. So we had a $1,000 account. And straight up, originally we had a 5-minute chart, less than 10 pips. We're going to 10 pips stop loss. And our team allows us to get our free multiple. In this trade, we already have 3% take to us. Now, we're going to assume that you've gone to the membership, you've gone to do this, and you've gone to the point where you are comfortable with live funds. Or maybe you're still in the account. If that's what's yours, you have to make a decision in the time frame for your own. Say, I can't do that for you. But take a look at this looking trade, and it's framed to stick around here. And it allows you to get a 2% position on. In other words, the trade is 2% risk. If you have the opportunity to get 3-1 payout, and you take that off your position, and you have 1% remaining, the first 1% payout off with multiple 3-1, you need to take profit 3 pips. You already bank 3%. Look what that does in month, by itself. It's over 10%. So even if all you get is the first profit of 3-1, so you frame your trade with a small risk, it's easy to get multiples of 3-1 more for reward. So our levels are easy to get to when you start finding risk. See, it's not having big risk that makes money. It's having the small risk that makes money. That's the real secret. The fact that you need to be able to frame your trade with one level that should see institutional sponsorship, that means should bank your price higher or lower because of the daily chart or weekly chart or monthly chart. Those levels are going to be highly impactful in terms of price action. They're going to drive price higher or lower to both of those levels because that's where the rewards are. It has nothing to do with anything. It has nothing to do with my demand. We're theory and price. It has nothing to do with that. It's where the rewards are. And we're going to around monthly, weekly, and levels. Now, if you let the portion of that second half go, and you have that 100 range, and we're going to set up as a potential available to you. But say you only let go of this, and you just couldn't bear hold until all you do, or you just don't get your stock out of the range, you already taken that first 1% off. This is the second 1% remaining trade. By itself, if you collapse at 50% of the range you're looking at, you're taking another 21%+ from that. All you're doing, you gotta be this one trade. You're focusing in tightly, watching one setup, and you're looking for everything that's worth, keeping it small, and looking for higher time frame objectives. If you do that, you're looking at 21%+ 21+ your original 3% in the first half of that trade. So what did we make? And you didn't need the entire range. Think about that. We use the same scenario, we use the stop, and we let the portion run after 3-1 take off the range. Then we let the range run until we only have that 100 range. Who would be upset? Would you be upset with that? I don't think you should. If you are, it's me. You can't allow me to do this to you. Now we have to get the entire range. So you get the take down. No one's on deal. You get the entire. The second portion of that trade nets you over 46%. That's in 1 month. Okay. If you let this continue to pay out, and you do this every single week, and you look for one and you get 100 of this take down on the second portion of the trade. Remember, you're taking parcels off every one. You get motion off. If you take 50%, what you're doing, you scale off 1% every one, and you wait for the second portion to reach higher time. That's how you get a lot of money. You pay yourself initially. You take your trigger. Take parcels. Don't let anyone money. You have to take yourself. Because you're not going to get out. Once you get 3-1, you're already leading in the market. That's all you have to do is get first back to 3-1. All you're doing is nothing. Who would you complain about that?
Here, ICT is trying to give us a couple of realistic examples of what to expect in the markets, depending on how you decide to manage your trades. One thing I'll point out is, yes, these are very realistic. It isn't impossible to do. He's definitely giving some reasonable returns and things like that. But just keep in mind that you won't be able to win every single time. There will be days and even weeks where you are not in your groove, or you're just not finding winning positions for yourself. So although this is very reasonable, I think it is also important to note that you will come across your losing streaks. And basically, the returns that you're seeing here won't be this picture perfect.
Only folks that are demanding beyond your personal efficiency rating. You can't do it. You don't have that level of efficiency yet. You can roll that over time, but you have to allow that time to take place. But if you get these one-shot kills, where you're looking for a nice weekly trade of 100 pip range, you don't need the 100 pip range to take out instantly. But you're going in for it, once in a while, and we'll just take out that from it. And you're going to assume from it, you're looking at 100 pip range. It may require you to do another trade to pay out to get the 100 pip. I'm not telling you force yourself to get 100 pip, but it may require you to do a second trade. You can lose. You know, you have encountered areas like a trade. But if you're making your second portion of your trade payout in a reasonable time frame, a low risk trade is in frame, a high time frame, the things I thought you focus on the month of September content. The second portion of the trade will always be more than the first. Obviously, you're being early with the partial. The partial is not a weakness. It's not an impediment to making money. When traders are here, I would say you're taking off some of the trade before you get to a profit that you had money beforehand. That's coming from someone that does not make money consistently. I'm telling you, because they're forcing themselves to hold on to their ultimate objective. And if you buy money, you have to take yourself money available. If you're buying it all or nothing, you're never going to be as good as you think you are. Believe me, I'm very personal for attention, but I don't demand everything all off my profit objective. I've learned to take myself. I've seen that I really have some profit in trade, but I did not allow myself to take something off my profit objective. Myself, never mind.
So here, I definitely understand what he's saying, and I do agree to a certain extent. It is important to take money from the markets as the markets are providing you the opportunity to make money from them. At the same time, keep in mind what your risk reward is relative to your win rate. Because obviously, if your win rate is 50% and you're always shooting for 1-to-1s, there might be situations where you're at a 1-2.5 and you decide, you know what, I'm going to take profits here because I heard it's good to take profits. So by the time price actually gets to your 1-to-1, did you really make 1-to-1? Meaning, did you risk $1 to make a dollar? Well, no, because you partialed halfway through it at that 0.5 mark. So when you think you're following your risk reward plan, but you're partialing halfway through, price gets to your TP, you'll start to realize that if you keep doing that and you are genuinely a 50% win rate trader, you actually won't be in a profitable position, or you actually won't be profitable at the end of the day because you aren't actually following the risk reward plan that you have set out for yourself.
The first portion of that trade off, and you only get 50 more tips. In other words, you've placed your trade on and paid yourself a monster tips. Move to the sidelines, and you only manage to get another 50 tips. What made your 10% rate on the second portion of the trade? Think about that. It's not about how many perfect excess energy you get. This is after your first profit. You pay yourself something and let the partial run. The balance has to run, and that will always pay you more. And here's the thing, it's a lot of effects of it not being a trade. Like, hey, you can take some skin off of it, and it's good. You get one time flash now, okay, for your time, your energy, and your focus in the marketplace. When you focus on trading on that, 10% in 1 month on the back end of your trade. That's not just, when you already factored in on your first portion of your trade, that goes without saying, that leads to 12% by itself. But if you can't do this short-term trade, you can still do trades like this. And that's still handsome. 10% compound over a year is over 300% for a year. And it's amazing. Where else are you going to get 300% return? There's no money to raise money. There's no money to raise money. I'll pop your money a year. I'm going to do that. I'm going to work hard for you. I'm going to work hard for your money. Okay, you're going to be really, really lazy. And you're going to watch your money like everybody else. So when you see things like this, it's really important you focus on that number. It's an astonishing number. You can do very, very well with trillion money a year. 10% in 1 month compound does that. Okay, folks. Welcome back. This is the fourth installment of month 2 of the Ask Me Mentorship. We're specifically talking about why losing on trades won't affect your profitability. What trading the fear of taking losses actually does to your trading? While staying concerned about taking a loss promotes fear-based decision-making. Equity that's managed by traders that cannot take a loss can't profit long-term. Losing is inevitable. Fear-based decision-making keeps focus on the adverse. Finally, fear-based decision-making fosters trade paralysis or inability to execute efficiently. Now, why profits are achievable despite taking reasonable losses? The professional equity manager understands that losses are cost of doing business. Using sound equity management and high probability setups yield handsome percent returns. Trading scenarios that encourage potential 3-1 reward ratios provide initial foundation. And finally, defining trade setups that frame 5-1 reward risk or more efficiently cover losses. Okay, let's give a brief overview on framing trade for the context of this discussion. Looking at this sample size of data as it relates to price action, we're going to be referring to a specific concept known as market setup and framing the risk to reward multiples. Obviously, we're going to use a standard in my repertoire, the bullish order block. As you see, the market returns to a previous institutional area of buying, noted by the down candle prior to the previous rally higher. By noting the down candle or the bullish order block high to open, price defines the fair value gap or most probable support. Now, specifically, inside of that retracement high to open, price defines the fair value gap or most probable support.
I'm trying to figure out why he considers this a fair value gap. Doesn't really explain why. Noting the down candle or bullish order block high to open, price defines the fair value gap or most probable support. So yes, the order block here, the last down move before the buy move, which actually he plotted up pretty well here, that price basically taps into. But I'm not sure exactly why he is classifying this as a fair value gap. My understanding, it would actually be from this wick low to this wick high here, where price made that gap. So I don't have an explanation here. But it looks like he is plotting up the wicks of that specific move.
Now, specifically, inside of that retracement to the order block, there's a mean threshold and hypothetical long entry on the secondary bullish order block. What I'm going to refer to is this down candle here. The middle of that candle, we're using that as a mean threshold, in order if we don't want to see that violated on a closing basis. And using 20 pips as the trade stop loss easily frames reward multiples of 3-1 reward risk and 5-1 reward risk, or even higher. Noting an old high, 20 pips above it gives us a nice objective above where price we'd be trading to.
I dare you, but let me build you a completely free e-commerce store, preloaded with...
Now, having a simple trade idea, based on the things we've talked about September, on what the focus on what you should focus on right now in price action, let's take a look at some things regarding those setups and how...
So he kind of breezed right by it. But he's plotting up this entire, well, not the entire, he's plotting up the down move here based on the candlestick bodies from open to close. And I believe he's plotting up the 50%. So I believe he's saying that the entry should be around here at the 50%. And then our take profit could be a tad bit higher. And here in this case, the risk is actually underneath the wick low, even slightly underneath it a bit more with extra wiggle room. I'm not sure exactly why that is. Especially, you know, the video, he actually decided to put the stop loss underneath the candlestick low, not underneath the wick low. So either way, here he's showing that the entry could be down here and the risk is down here and the take profits are up here, and you could potentially catch a 1-to-3, 1-to-5 RR trade. Well, I guess here's using 20 pips as a trade stop loss easily frames reward multiples of blank. So actually, in this case, the reason why he uses a stop loss down here even underneath the wick low is because he's trying to make a standard cookie cutter model of how to take a trade and how to set up a stop loss and take profit. So that actually makes sense.
Also, easily frames reward multiples of 3-1 reward risk and 5-1 reward risk, or even higher. Noting old high, 20 above it is a nice objective above where price will be trading to. Now, having a simple trading idea, based on the things we talked about in September, on what to focus on, what you should focus on right now in price action, let's take a look at some things regarding those sales and how you can frame good reward multiples, how you can frame the ideas and justify why taking losing trades doesn't really or shouldn't have that much of an impact on your long-term profitability. We're going to assume that we're using a hypothetical account size of $5,000. And we're starting with a low accuracy rate of 30%. That means you're losing 70% of the time. We're looking for trades that are reward to risk ratio of 3-1. That means we're hoping to make or $1 to trade to pay out $3 gained for $1 that we risk. We're risking on each trade 1% of $5,000.
So what I'm assuming here is he is going to go over a realistic example of a trader that has these conditions. Ultimately, as we went over a couple of videos ago, if a trader is always using a 1-3 risk reward, they would only need to have a 25% win rate to be break even. So anything above that will be profitable. So in this case, since this trader has a 30% accuracy rate, they should be profitable in the long run.
Okay. Because we're risking 1% and looking for a yield of 3-1 reward to risk. Our average win trade should be $150 and our average loss should be $50 for 1%. We're focusing on a sample set of 10 trades, and we're going to say that 30% of the 10 trades are wins, and obviously 70% would be losing trades. Out of those 10 trades, we're assuming that 3 wins in 10 trades and 7 losses in 10 trades. The average profit, again, is $150, and the average loss, again, is $50. So total for 3 wins and average profit of $150 bring us to a $400 win basis on 3 trades out of 10 wins. And so total for losses would equate to $300 or 7 times $50 average loss. Even this low accuracy rate with a multiple 3-1, you still can marginally eke out a net positive profit. It's not much, and look at that, it doesn't seem like anyone would be terribly excited about that. But if you're doing 10 trades over the course of a month and you get a 2% return, I tell you that is an absolutely amazing return for managed funds. So if you're not going to trade your own capital, or if you're starting to be a trader that manages money, 2% while that's not terribly impressive, in the grand scheme of things, 2% compounded over the course of a calendar year, 2% per month, that is an astronomical return for managed funds.
So as you can see there, in the long run, they are still profitable. It may not seem like it is a ton of profit and you may not be satisfied with it, but ultimately they are profitable, they are making money, and in the long run, it is actually going to be great returns.
Now we're going to start focusing on reward risk levels of 5-1, that means we're trying to make $5 or $1.
So in this one, same thing, 30% win rate or accuracy rate, but they're going to be using a 1-5 risk reward. So in this case, they will be, or they should be making more money in the long run.
We're keeping the same sample set of 10 trades, and we're still looking at the accuracy rate of 30%. Only change now for frame trades at a multiple of 5-1 reward risk. Suddenly, our frame trades of 10 sample set, the average profit becomes $200 or 3 wins at $200 average, versus a total of $750. The 7 losses in sample set of 10 trades, average loss of $60, still gives us a total of $350. $750 minus $300 gives us a net profit of $400 or 8% return. Again, if we're looking at 10 trades over the course of one calendar month, the C result is with a very, very low accuracy rate of 30%, still brings us 8% return. That's a wonderful return for monthly rate. Now we're going to take a look at having a low accuracy rate of 3% with a reward risk multiple of 5-1. And now
same thing as the last, but instead of risking 1%, it is going to be 2%. So it should be the same thing, but doubled.
We're risking 2% right now. So the average win jumps to $5 and the average loss jumps to $100. Again, keeping accuracy at a low 30% accuracy, that means we're losing 7% trades. At the same set of 10 trades, we can close a month, 3 wins at 2% risk per trade, multiple of 5-1 reward risk. Our average profit jumps to $5. Our 3 win trades at $5 average profit gives us a total of $1,500. Our 7 losing trades at an average loss of $100 or 2% of our equity. And the subtotal will obviously be at 7%. The average loss and average profit would increase as the equity increase drops. But for example, looking at the sample size of the and a sample set of 10 trades, so the details are mentioned here on a very high-level basis. But the subtotal on 3 wins of $15 and 7 losses, subtotal $700 and $750. Or 15% return. Again, crazy returns, which is a very low accuracy. Think about some of them. You first trade, you're running 90% accuracy, 100% accuracy, 98% accuracy. You can still make ridiculous returns without very low accuracy. You don't need high accuracy. You need the frame of reward risk models in
your favor. And yep, you don't need a high win rate. Even with a low win rate, you can still bring back big returns. So don't feel like you always need to have that 90% win rate that you see a lot of people online claiming that they have. And honestly, most likely they don't even have. But again, it is not even needed. Same thing, but increasing the accuracy rate to 40%. So of course, they'll just make more money.
4 of 10 trades, trades, average profit trades of $5. 4 trades of $500, average profit of $2,000. 6 losing trades of 10, average loss of $3,000 loss. 6 losing trades of $6,000. That gives a net profit of $1,400, which is a 20% return, which is a 10% increase in accuracy, a factor of 2% risk, and reward ratio again, depending on model 5-1. Now we'll get an increase in accuracy, which is a dream for a while, we know our dream model, we know what we're dreaming about.
Same thing, just increasing the accuracy, so they're making more money. Same thing, just increasing it by 10% once again.
High end yield for 20% You have to trade every month for money or other people's money. This is not mobile because it gives you cushion to do basically half the trade. There are some months that you don't really want to trade. So if you do multiple, a 5-1 and yield, really hands-on the same, everyone's going to be higher every month. This would be the trade for you to frame your trade room. We're expecting only half the trade to be accurate. Frame 5-1 risk, giving your risk low 1%. By doing this, it gives you the optimal objectives, it gives you hanging fruit, it gives you forced performance, and it gives you an opportunity to relax and enjoy the process of trading. There's no fear, it's just about taking losses. They are all part of the business, all part of the game, it's all part of your job as an equity manager. You don't do better losses, you don't do some losing trades, it's all part of the business. No one knows your fear without taking losses. You don't have losses, you trade a long time. If you have a column of wins or losses, your losses are going to be very, very long list.
So ultimately here, you will encounter losses, but don't allow that to discourage you. Don't allow that to break you down and make you believe that you are a bad trader. As you can see, you can still make crazy returns, crazy gains by even being 30% accurate. If you have the right risk-reward plan, it'll work out in the long run. And this is why I stated, be very careful when you take partials, because when you think you're taking a 1-5, but you're taking partials all the way up, at the end, you're really not ending with the 1-5. It's probably going to be like a 1-2, 1-3, depending on how much you actually partial throughout it. So once again, please keep that in mind.
But then, the event was not removed. The profitability factor is still illustrated now for entry-level models, or reward risk, gain risk, managing and fund, and thinking about how to trade with these parameters. If you use the exemption in the video, which is going to stop by the state, what was 1% of $5,000? It's $50. So if you stop, you buy that by $50. Now you get $1 per tip leverage, and that's what you use for your trade. And that would be all these numbers here. Now again, we don't see that as a level, but it's a rule or general principle that you're going to build on as a trader. Time is that. You don't need high access, not show 6%, 6%, 6%, 6%, 8%, 9%. None of that's necessary. But as time goes on, you grow in your persistency, you understand the 5% and you as a trader. By default, your accuracy rate will increase. And you'll never demand more need for the higher than 50-50. So the next session, next teaching, wish you luck and your trade. Okay, folks, welcome back. This is teaching number 5 in the second month of the guys team membership. We're talking specifically about how to mitigate losing trades effectively. We're going to look back at the same sample size of price action, and we're going to go through it a little bit differently. We're going to assume that we were studying this particular asset class or market, and we go through our standard markup of market setup and frame the risk and reward multiples. And we noted the bull short block, and we identified where the market went back down into it. And we identified the mean threshold and the long entry on the secondary bullish order block. Now, assuming for a moment that we saw this down candle here, okay? It's all supporting the idea that we should see some buying or recapitalization of this down candle. We see that happening here. Now, we don't know for sure, but assume for a moment that we went in and we took a long one decision, okay? Understanding the mean threshold, I don't see the middle of the down candle or bull short block be violated. Because some of you are all new, and there are chances that you probably take a trade and want to have a stop loss just a little bit below this mean threshold. There's nothing wrong with that normally, but let's say, for instance, you did that and you got stopped out, okay? What would you do? Assume you did that and you got stopped out. What would you do? Obviously, I'm going to throw you a plot twist. You can say that you got a stop out here and you get a full 2% loss score if you're a hot shot and you think you're really, an elite trader, if you will, you risk 1-2% probably, would have been burned pretty bad. And if you're a gambler and you risk a lot of money in trades like that, and you don't feel any pain, that's a problem. But we don't need to take huge risks, we don't need to take a lot of trades, but we will encounter losing trades. So I'm going to give you a scenario in a supermarket. We saw this candle, we saw the idea that there should be some upside, but we could stop also too close to the market, so we took a full stop. Now, assuming that we took that long position and our stop was below the threshold and hit our stop, let's assume for a moment that our maximum leverage and risk on the trade would be at a full 2%. Well, that means we had to take another look at the same trade and reevaluate the some new trade. Obviously, we had our mindset on this potential setup initially. But if the trade hasn't completely unraveled, just because it swept us out below the mean threshold on initial try going long, it doesn't mean the trade's completely no longer viable. It just means that we probably were just inaccurate in terms of our stop loss place, and we have to take another stab at it. So now we take a look at that new order block that forms with this down candle. Price trades the way through it on this candle right here. It trades above that down candle, so when it does that, it authorizes any new return to this down candle as a buying opportunity. We're coming down to it here. Okay, we can take a long position here. Okay, now this time, we're going to allow a little bit more movement against us. Okay, because we still have a strong conviction, or hypothetically, a strong conviction the market should be higher. The difference is we're going to go about our leverage a little bit differently and allow ourselves a little bit more movement against us. We're going to be so high strong about getting our stop loss this time. Our stop loss is actually below.
So looking back at it, I'm actually thinking that he actually placed a long somewhere in here. I was thinking he was waiting for price to come back to the 50%, that mean threshold, and then take long. But he actually was looking too long somewhere, I'm assuming, on that bullish pushback on up. I honestly don't know for sure. But what he's saying here is that even if you take that long over here and price stops you out, that doesn't invalidate the overall bullish bias. And in those cases, there are most likely going to be other opportunities for us to take another stab at it. So don't completely give up on that bullish bias until obviously it is fully invalidated. Sometimes our stop losses could be a tad bit too tight. Stop us out. But once again, don't be too frustrated on that. But what he's showing here is that after price makes that new high, gives us that big bullish push, we can use this range from this low to high, anticipate price to pull back, and then take another stab at it is what I'm seeing. And even if you miss that, we have another low to a high, allow price to pull back, and then take another stab at it again. So as you can see, there are multiple opportunities for us to jump back in, even if we do lose the first or maybe even second time as well.
It's the way through it on this candle right here. It's above that down candle, so it does that, that authorizes any new return to this down candle as a buying opportunity. Mark comes down to it here. Okay, we can take a long position here. Okay, now this time, we're going to allow a little bit more movement against us. Okay, because we still have a strong conviction, or hypothetically, a strong conviction, market should be higher. The difference is we're going to go about our leverage a little bit differently and allow ourselves a little bit more movement against us. We're going to be so high strong about getting our stop loss this time. Our stop loss is going to actually be below the order block that we're framing trade. So the market has created a down candle, showing one's the wrong way, off support of the previous down candle, which is a bullish order block. We saw one stop loss line with the movement from this here, came back down, we're going to be higher, right in here, top of that candle. Okay, so we did that, and we used the bottom of the candle as a stop loss. What are we going to do differently with this? Well, we're going to go long with one half of the position size we used on the initial loss. So, for instance, if we took an initial loss of 2% in the first trade, we have to go down to 1%. If we're trading with 1% and we're full loss on the initial trade, we have to drop down to one half 1% of the equity base. Now, if the initial loss is 2% of the equity base, this trade again would be 1% of the equity base in total risk. So, we're defining trade by entry at the top of this body's this down candle, maybe opening, so we begin long in here. Okay. If we were elected to use this down candle as an entry, we can see the return back down into this down candle as well. Using that either way, we're going to use this range to find the opening of this down candle or the top of this down candle as our entry. either instance on this movement down or this movement down here would have given the fill. This is our code, risk, stop below the order block. Main thing is we're using half of the leverage in position size that we used on the initial loss. So we're defining our trade with this in terms of the risk. Now, all we're going to do is refer back to the original idea of that trade where we first took a loss, hypothetically, and we're finding out the idea that the same thing would be seen, hopefully, if we're right in our directional premise. With one movement up, that would be a multiple of R1. So if we have 1% at risk, defined by the entry in here, and stop below here, once we get to this price point here, we're already at 1% return. So we got half of our initial loss back, including profit. Once we get one more standard deviation from what our risk is defined by, we're already at 2% mitigated. In other words, our losing trade we just had using half of the initial risk is already mitigated. Now, at this point here, this is one of the differences if you're a new trader. This is where you want to consider taking the trade off. And I can't stress this enough. Sometimes it's just good to get back to even and relax and then regroup, especially if you're late in the week. For instance, say you've been trading all week and you took a loss and it's a Thursday or Friday now and you get the opportunity to get 2% full stop out back. Take it off. Close the week flat. Do not go on the weekend with that loss. If the market presents the opportunity to give you that loss back and you're late in the week for your late trading session, take it off the table, move to the sidelines, and be glad you did. There's nothing saying this is going to continue going higher. So that's why once the market gets an opportunity to erase our errors, do so. Notice that.
I think that's a good idea, being able to get back to break even, get us out of that psychological mindset that most of us have of trying to revenge trade, trying to get back up, or maybe even in profit at times that we're down. So when we have the opportunity to get back to break even, I think it is good, even if price hasn't reached the high in this case, hasn't reached the full target that you anticipate in this at this point, since you took a 2% loss, gaining back the 2%, closing here would be a good psychological thing to do. One thing I would critique is, yes, there's different ways of doing this, but me personally, I wouldn't minimize my risk by dropping my risk by half. And the reason that is because it messes with the risk reward plan that we basically have been going over. If you're always shooting for 1 to 2s, meaning you're always risking $1 for 2, if you half your lot size or half your contract size, you're no longer risking 1 for 2. You're risking 0.5. for 1. And obviously in the long run, that is going to mess up the numbers, the calculations that you had in mind. So keep that in mind. Once again, very similar to the partials, it sounds great, but in the long run, it could potentially hinder you if you don't take mind of it. Same thing here, it sounds great to kind of take a step back, minimize your risk, and go that route. But in the long run, it could potentially hurt you if you are not keeping these factors in mind.
Making 2% of the initial trade loss, for the initial trade total loss of 2% equity, we don't even require market trading above the old highs in here where the buy stops are residing. So notice we're already able to mitigate the initial loss of a total 2% hit on equity, and it hasn't even really fully moved through our objectives. Obviously, with a multiple of 3R, we are now in new territory. So now we've made a new net gain. If you're going to allow the position, and not listen to what I suggested, this is where you want to trail stop loss up to, where you can no longer lose back below open profit of the 2% loss. Once it's mitigated, you're locked that in. So your trailing stop loss will be placed right there, and you're not permitted the market to come back against you.
This is heavy. It's warm. Loads box. I'm impressed with it. This is the best skin. Tactical hoodie. Thousands of.
And it stops you out. Bottom line is, you're not going to go back down below. If you get an opportunity to recoup the drawdown, take it for lock in. So cannot take it back down below. Your equity reference point before the drawdown ensued. Once we get multiple R3.
I think that's a good idea as well. The way I personally handle these is, if you get that big bullish push with lots of volume, you have the opportunity to basically move your stop loss to that 1 to 2 RR. And at this point, if price comes back and hits your stop loss or your chilling stop, whatever you want to call it, you're basically still at break even, so there really is no harm in holding this trade. If price does not shoot past this, as it does here with lots of volume, and price kind of stalls, to be honest, I really won't chance it. I will take my 1 to 2, get back to break even, and call it a day. So once again, if you get that big bullish push, I would recommend then at that point you can move your stop loss to a chilling position to recoup that loss. But if not, just take it and call it a day.
Three, okay, in my opinion, that's about where you want to take your profits and square. So either you take it off once you make your loss entirely, and you are two, okay, that's going to basically pay you back whatever your loss was percentage-wise. Even if you cut that trade, leverage in half, regardless of what it is, you only need a multiple of R2 to get that trade paid back to you, okay? And how many times we talk about opportunities, how there's so many opportunities with the frame 3, 1, 5, 1, or more throughout the week, you don't need very much to get that losing trade back. That's why it's something that's not requiring you to spend a lot of time fearful of or assessing that until you take a loss. They're easy to get back, you just got to align your mindset to stay focused. Once the market provides you R2 or the negation of your initial loss, you want to lock that in, and then give the market room if you want to not take the 2% back off or whatever the initial loss was, you don't take off and repay your drawdown and bring it back to the equity base, equity high, rather, prior to the drawdown. You want to at least lock that in. Initially, as your development trader, you want to take it off the table and just be thankful you got that. As you grow into the next stage of development, you want to start locking your stop loss after you get your loss mitigated and see if anything more going to go. But initially, you want to not do that. You want to train yourself to say, okay, I fixed my error, I corrected the drawdown, I'm going to move to the sidelines and start fresh. Okay. The next stage would be, lock that in, and don't allow your drawdown to return, and see if it has room to run again. In this case, if you allow the market to run, and you mitigate your 2% loss after testing R2 multiple with 1% risk, now you have 1% gain, so you have an equity high, all in the same trade. All of this has been done in the scope of just one setup that you may have messed up, you may have got in and got too aggressive about your stop loss should be. Or sometimes you just look around and you start running and go to a level that would make perfect sense after you see it do it. But because some of us are very emotional, very rushed to get into the decision, there's no reason to fear going back and taking a look at that trade. How many times have you incurred a loss and you knew there was still probability for possibly seeing that trade pan out and direction you thought was going to go initially, but you're too afraid to go back and lose money? If you drop down your amount of leverage and your total risk, cut it in half, okay? Let's take those out just for a moment. Say we bought this one here, okay? We bought this one here, and then we use the mean threshold as a stop and a stop as a here. And then we use this down candle and price, ran back down into it, okay? We went long, and say for instance, We did the same thing. We were using this middle of the scale here, and we have ultra short-term stop loss, and it came down against us. We did that. Or did it scare us? Okay, and market runs again. When it comes back down into this order block here, that'll be another opportunity. So if you started with what? If you started with 2% here on this trade here, and you got knocked out, and you have full stop, you're looking like you're having that. Probably next to impossible, but we're going to take a full stop at 2% here on this full stop. Say you took a 1% full hit here on this, being aggressive, trying to place your stop way too short in the threshold. Okay, and you stop again. You have to go down to 1.5% right here. Okay, so again, with that same mindset, if we're using an entry, we're going this basis, and stop, we have to go below this low now. Look at the range between this candle's opening right here and this low. Think about that in terms of the range. That would be your risk. Okay, watch what happens. There's 1.5%, 1%, 1.5%, 2%. You still would have made back your 2%. Just on that run here. So your initial large hit of 2%, even with 0.5% would have mitigated. So then you only down what? 1%. And you can actually let the market run or take another setup. It doesn't come back. It doesn't come back in all one trade. No, one trade doesn't erase all your losses. But don't think that you can't make the money back or mitigate the losses, okay, without increasing more risk. You can actually do it.
And that's with the assumption that the risk is going to be that tight. Obviously, if your risk is the same exact risk as the previous ranges, meaning your risk or your stop loss has to be just as wide, you're going to have to shoot for more pips or more ticks to get to that break-even point. But in this case, technically, yes, the risk is a lot smaller in terms of pips. So hitting that higher RR is going to be a lot easier.
By reducing risk. And I taught this principle years ago online, and folks that saw it, they're like, this is stupid. Why would I want to cut my risk or my leverage down after losing trade? Well, it's because equity preservation is the number one rule in this game. And we don't know with any solution that our trade can be profitable. So why would any trader think like a moron and not dial back their leverage? If they take a losing trade, that means you're doing something wrong. The likelihood of you going in and making a winning trade in the next trade is a new trader, highly unlikely, because you're going to rush to get back to square one. You want to get that loss back right away. And most likely, that's your thinking. But it's not necessary to get back on that trade. But in this example, it's very important. You can see, getting to that R3, you can get back your full 2%, if that was the case. You don't need to have increased leverage, you don't have to increase your risk, but you do have to have patience to allow that loss to be mitigated. And you don't need to do it by scaling up your risk. You have to do it by scaling back your risk. Because if, say, for instance, that your first hit 2%, you got 2% loss, how do you know that you're getting a 10-string losing? In other words, let's say you don't get 9 more losing trades in a row. It can happen to you. It can happen to me, it can happen to anyone. So if you do that, and you keep going at 2% or worse, you increase your risk. You're throwing good money at bad, you're building toxic thinking, you're allowing yourself to be beaten down emotionally, you're spending a lot of mental capital, and you're going to grow into fear-based trading. And we also have fear-based trading that doesn't produce a lesson.
So to reiterate, I don't think it's a stupid idea. Just be aware of what you're doing and how it affects the numbers in the long run.
Hey folks, welcome to the sixth teaching of Legacy Mentorship. We're going to simply dealing with the secrets to high reward trading setups. Now, some of you may have already went through my trading plan development series. It was a long video series, had a lot of information. It was only aimed for those individuals that never really had exposure to the marketplace, giving them ideas on what direction to go and what to focus on primarily. And while it is a great deal of information for any of you, it is necessary to go through this thinking. It has to give you, well, not it doesn't have to, but when you're first starting out, it's important you have a mentor, you have a framework or foundation built on to give your training for your direction. One of the most recurring things in my role as a mentor is, where do I begin, which I do first, where should I focus my attention at, now, which I'll be studying, okay? And while the training development series is still good, still valuable in my opinion, not that I need it because it's useful, some of you in the majority actually are actually really exposed to my content and my materials related to training, specifically to foreign exchange. But I think that if one were to look at what I actually do on a day-by-day basis, what is the procedure with the things I do to elect a specific stance in the marketplace, what makes me bullish, what makes me bearish, why do I focus on one currency or another, all those things are decisions and processes. And while we have specifics in relationship to how I arrive at individual specific views or decision points as it relates to how everything fits together in my decision process, it's important to start with kind of a micro version of the trading series in this teaching as this is. While it's not going to be comprehensive as the trading series was, this is going to be a more specific, more salient to the things I do as a specific forex trader. I don't look at all the things that the trading series, of course, spoke about. They do occasionally come up in my thought process, but they're not all required to come to a trading decision. Okay, so I'm going to go through a lot of things that I believe that if you can expose at least all my free tutorials, I'll be able to get down to a little more process and decision-based parameters in this teaching. Now, it's important also that we go into this with our mindset. Okay, I don't want to thinking we're going into trade signals, we're not talking about trade patterns, we're not talking about stop loss placement or trade management. Those things are important here. This is the last primer for us before we start going into the specifics. So breaking down individual decisions, each process, which as a collective whole, as we'll discuss in this teaching, you'll see that that's how the ICT mindset is. And what we do on a day-by-day basis, we frame our opinion about certain things, and when we change those opinions, and when we move this on, all those things come by way of process thinking. Okay, and it's important that you understand that while entry signals and stop placement and patterns and order blocks and order flow and all the ICT jargon and things that get really exciting, there's got to be a little bit of dry information presented to you, and it's important. So I want you to look at this video and go through it and walk away with this is going to teach you anything. It really is teaching you. It's going to teach you how, number one, to think in terms of foundations, because we have to understand where we're building one to elect a decision relative to whether we're going to buy or sell or where we're staying on the sidelines. Okay, that's the real secret to trading, understanding what makes the process arrive at a decision. What is the process? What are the components that help you arrive at whether you're trader, buying or selling or staying on the sidelines? And what has that process to trade? What specific pairs we're going to be dealing with foreign exchange as we are in this teaching? All these things will be a little clearer, a lot more clear, by having the process that I'm going to introduce here. Now, obviously, there has to be a specific order, okay, depending on what we do, what it is that we do as a trader, what makes our decisions, increment, what we do first, what we focus on first. Now, obviously, I've been a strong supporter of the notion that every trader needs to have patience, obviously, and after patience, then we have to understand, obviously, what defines trade environments, are the environments conducive for trading right now. That's a topic that obviously goes largely taught by the majority of everyone that's teaching as courses or what they do in terms of teaching the populace. And I do a lot of work with that in this mentorship, and it's going to be a lot more across the entire mentorship. I don't have one specific teaching to talk about when you shouldn't trade. There's going to be a lot of things that come by experience and learning that define those environments. Okay. The next stage is obviously to determine a trade parameter. What makes your trading by yourself? What gives you those notions to take action? Obviously, it's not simply what is going on for the last 6 minutes on the buy, or is it going lower because of interest rate nothing. Obviously, it's going to have to be very defined. Okay. It has to be specific. It has to be binary. You do this or you don't do this. Okay. Do X or do Y. Okay. It has to be a very black or white decision process. If you don't have your trading plan or your perspective or process, determine whether you want to trade or buy yourself or something on the side, it will create a huge vacuum where lots of emotional, psychological, and impulsive trading will creep in. And if you don't have these binary thought processes and where you're dealing with in terms of decision making, you won't have any structure. And without structure, without having a refined, clear trading model, what defines your trading, what makes your trading model uniquely yours, you control. And the matter teaches you, principle is going to trade with, it's going to be an impossible endeavor if you do not become highly organized. So yes, after a long period of time setting different charts and working with individuals and myself as a trader, I'm always a student, always learning about myself as a trader, not so much about the market anymore. I don't mean to sound arrogant, but most of my learning comes by way of my individual experience as a trader.
Based on what he's saying so far, I definitely agree. Based on what he's showing here with the step-by-step way of finding high reward trading setups, first things first, have patience. You definitely don't want to come to the market impatient, looking for things that aren't there. Define trade environments. This probably can come in many different ways, and I'm sure he'll break it down more in detail, but it could be simply of, hey, I'm only going to trade at this specific time, and that is it. So trying to figure out what environments are going to be best for you, or, hey, let's not trade during these specific environments, such as news events. Let's stay away. The next thing, determine trade parameters. As he pointed out, it should be very binary. There will be times where, yeah, it might be a little gray. It might be a little bit of intuition. It might be a little bit of nuances here and there. But for the most part, you should try to make it as binary as possible so it can be replicated day in and day out.
To help you find your trade parameters. And next, obviously, you need to know what makes your execution criteria. What is what makes you be a buyer or a seller? And you know, having those parameters defined, it's not simply, I'm bullish now. Okay, well, if you're bullish, what would you do to be a buyer? And what would make that buying scenario negative? What would change the tone of your price? Would you be a limited size line? Or if you have stop loss, do you still consider being a buying position? And these things have to be specific. You have to be highly refined. It's got to be like a flow chart format. You have to go from one step to the next. And if it's not like that, again, you're going to be very emotional. You're going to be very influenced by the things you see in the price action. And worse, by online media, forums, Twitter, Facebook, people talk to you and your work and your friends that you know they're traders. All these things are going to be influential to you and to be detrimental to your performance as a trader. So we don't care about the thing, we don't care about what their trading model is. In fact, we're trying to share our trading model. It's a unique trading plan and trading model for you. Okay, and you're the one that defines yourself. And that's going to be your reputation. When you know exactly what's going to be training your trading model. And you got a lot of help along the way through the months of this mentorship. They have to be defined by you. I can't force you to be a trader. I can't force you to be a trader. I can't force you to be a trader. You'll know which one that is for you by the end of this mentorship. And you have to understand why the trade should change. Understand what makes the trade viable. Okay, it's not simply I see a trade pattern here, or I believe I'm bullish, or I believe I'm bearish in the marketplace. There has to be a real understanding why that scenario should take place. And largely, this is going to come by experience. Okay, and obviously, that experience comes by taking action in the account. And when you do, that experience should be logged and kept for future reference. That's the only way you're really going to learn. Obviously, if you don't have an account, you can only buy and sell, and just wait and see the outcome. And you want to attribute the winning trade as your trader, and losing trade, whatever you have to do for the difference. That doesn't help you as a developing trader. So the real secret to finding high reward trade sales is that, number one, you have to know what is specifically looking for when you find the information. So before we get into all these things, I want you to understand that it's crucial to understand that efficiency in trading comes by the process of thinking. It doesn't come by way of reaction or impulsive thinking, which also.
So with the executable criteria, should be relatively binary as well. It may be different from trader to trader, but it is important to find something that works best for you. You may have an overall bias of what you believe price will do, but what is the criteria? What are the clues that were given for you to actually enter the market at that specific time or moment? Understand why it should pan out. Having the, let's say, higher time frame context clues to help you understand why price will play out a certain way. Maybe it's some type of news event forecast that you think price will come out in a specific direction. Whatever it is that you're using, try to understand the why behind it and build that story behind it. And of course, experience for future reference. It will take experience and time to build up that confidence, build up that experience to use it for future moments as well.
Leads to rushing ahead and trade signals prematurely. I can tell you, if we were all going to sit top of my email box and look at some of the things I got by the feedback, it's the recurring thing is, I want to see trade, I want to see entry, I want to see, give me in, give me out, that type of perspective. And I understand that, I get that, okay? But I can tell you, being from where you are right now, where I am now, I'm saying this for you, I can tell you that's not what you need to know right now, and it doesn't feel good to hear that. It feels like I'm leaning down the front of the lane, it feels like I'm just deferring, you know, something that you think you need to have right now, and that's not true. What it is you have to develop a process-oriented thinking, and that means I can show you order blocks. You know, I can show you breakers, I can show you institutional workflow, return back to mitigation block, I can show you examples of that. But until you understand the process behind why these things should be doing what they're going to do, it's going to be really, so no help to you. It's going to feel like I'm demonstrating choice. It's going to feel like I'm showing you what this is what I can do. And that's not what this is all about. It's to show you with an intimate experience, on a day-by-day basis, a weekly basis, a teaching tutorial basis, a theme generalized over the month, okay, that builds on your total understanding. The folks that are struggling right now are the folks that are really trying to be reactionary or they're impulsively thinking about what they want to do right now. And it's the hardest thing for traders to do when they first get involved with money. They have this insatiable desire. They have to train right now. They want to get in. They want to take signals. Okay? And I spent the entire first month of September on a day-by-day basis showing you there are a plethora of trade signals all the time. We were laser-guided precision. There's no reason for you to be feeling rushed. I couldn't change. Okay, the way price is delivered. None of these concepts that I've had. Okay, it still works. But I needed to show you the first month that there's nothing that's going to hinder your ability to find signals because there's always a lot of them. The problem is you don't know what defines this setup for you as a trader, and you're not going to have a process where you're thinking that leads you to high reward trade setups. And it comes by experience, comes by showing conceptual ideas and a broad brush idea of breaking down what it is that we look for in the market and where the information resides. So it's important before we get into this, this is important to focus on the fact that what I'm showing you in this teaching, while it doesn't give you technicals, it doesn't give you trade scenarios, it doesn't give you specific things. I'm of the mindset that this is exactly what I needed to be told when I first started the trade. No one was around to tell me these things. No one had the experience around me where I had the avenue of reaching them like you have with me. You have a very intimate relationship with me as a mentor, you're on the same time. And I'm investing a lot of my time by way of my experience, and it takes a lot of time to communicate that because I've talked about someone who's been doing this for decades or more. And there's a lot of lessons I learned, and there's a lot of lessons that I resisted initially. And some of those are the same things I'm warning you that you're feeling right now. You know you're feeling right now. You're feeling that you're in the reaction impulse thinking. Okay, and you change that suppress that hard and that's hard. But you're not going to get to high reward trade scenarios. Okay, they can find very quickly in the right now, and professional traders are not in a rush to the money work. They want to sit back and wait for a scenario that makes sense. So if we were all in a room, and everyone had a chance to ask me something, I can tell you, the number one recurring question, if we were all to write down a paper, that I'm not supposed to say, that no one had any reason to repeat it. The question comes by way of, what makes me think this order box is going to do what? Or what makes me think that this level is going to keep price from going higher? Why do I think the juice swing should go up after midnight and then sell off? What are all these things? And I understand why you're asking those questions and the same questions that I had on the market. Like, again, I had my director's questions too. But it's important to understand that there's no way I can actually answer that question to you now because we haven't gone through all the things that are necessary for me to actually answer that. It's almost like I'm creating an additional language on top of what you've already arrived at by going through my free tutorials. And that's why I require 12 months with me because it's going to basically beat in your brains by hearing over and over again, specifically dealing with it on a basis daily, involvement on the application of it. And that's going to be, you know, the takeaway. You don't have experience, whereas if this were a book or having some DVDs or CDs and you watch them, it'll be facilitated. You can come away with, well, that's cool. I can see how it works sometimes or I can see how it works in the past, but you don't have the intimate relationship of sitting down and going through the process and explain why it should take place. We did some of that on a micro scale in September, but we need to go through a process of outlining, you know, what the beginning foundation is going to be because as we go into the fourth, fifth, sixth month, they're going to be greatly focused on the components that make up the trade templates. Okay, in other words, at the end of the membership, you're actually going to get a flowchart for when to be a buyer, for some trades, when to be a seller, for some trades. Every specific decision point that goes through my head is a figure, and what tools you use for each decision point, and what the responses you have. Everything that we use, everything that I go through in my tools, for short-term trades, same way, when to be a buyer, when to be a seller, you know, what makes trade order good, where does my stop go, when do I do my stop, all the decisions that go through my mental process, okay? Because everything I do is process orienting, and it comes across as, well, you're just really good at this, and it's not that I'm good at it, it's just I'm experienced at it, and I know what decision I need to make right now, and sometimes it's some sidelines. And because I've done it so long, that experience gives me reference to go to mentally, and it only takes a few seconds sometimes to write the marks and go based on these processes. Now, while it seems like it's great information I'm following here, it's important that you really, really listen. So if you're listening to the video, because there's no charts here, you need to sit down and listen. Don't be watching TV, don't have your kids, you know, sidelines, you need to get into this one, because it's important.
I agree with that a lot as well, because as a new trader or even a trader in general, we want to get in the markets as quick as possible. We want to make money as quick as possible, meaning we think we understand what an order block is. So then we're out there trying to buy every single order block. We understand how to spot a fair value gap. So then we plot every fair value gap and just try to long and short from that. But what he's trying to show us, yes, you may understand what these things are, but it is important to understand the process behind it, understand the experience behind it, understand the story behind it on why you're doing what you are doing. So be patient, take things slow. There's some things where he won't be able to answer you yes or no. There are going to be little nuances and experience type of scenarios that you have to go through yourself to understand the bigger picture of things. So once again, be very patient and understand the why behind things, build that story, and then things will come together.
Now, while it seems like it's a great deal of information I'm dropping here, it's important that you really, really listen. So if you're listening to the video, because there's no charts here, you need to sit down and listen. Don't be watching TV, don't be having your kids, you know, sidelines are getting distracted, you need to get into this one, because lines of ICT-related information. Obviously, again, we're not talking about the trade development series, okay? It's like a micro-scale version of all that stuff, so we're going to go right into where the information is going to reside and what you're going to be looking for in these specific areas of study. Before we get any high reward trades up, we have to understand, obviously, it's going to be a big picture perspective, okay? And when I say big picture perspective, it's primarily four areas of reference. It's going to be macro, market analysis, it's going to be interest rate analysis, intermarket analysis, and seasonal influences. The next area of study is going to be for an intermediate perspective. We're looking at top-down analysis, CFT data, which is familiar traders, and market sentiment. And for our short-term perspective, we're looking at correlation analysis, time and price theory, and IFTA, which is the event price theory algorithm. Now, looking closer at the big picture perspective, I'm going to take a look at what makes up our big picture perspective. Obviously, there's four areas of study, and again, macro market analysis, interest rate analysis, intermarket analysis, and seasonal influences. When we look at the big picture perspective, okay, while there's four areas of study, we're going to need to primarily focus on at least two of these that have to come to agreement. Okay, what I mean by that is our macro analysis, our interest rate analysis, our intermarket analysis, and seasonal influences. All four of these do not have to agree. Okay, but you do need to have two of these components to arrive at your big picture perspective. Okay? In other words, our grand scheme of things, our big picture perspective, okay, is going to be defined by at least two of these areas of study that have to come to agreement. It doesn't matter which of these four that you elected to subscribe to, but they have to come to agreement. So let's get a little bit more information about each one of these four. Okay, so again, focusing on the big picture perspective, the first thing we're looking at is the macro market analysis. Now, this is really simply described as, are we in an inflationary market or are we in a deflationary market? The market or a currency or country is in an inflationary condition. It's going to have a direct relationship on the currency. Obviously, when you're in a deflationary market condition, it's going to have a relationship or a response to the currency. It also, in terms of equities, it's going to have a direct relationship. That's when we talk about commodities, we'll talk about stock prices later on in this membership. Inflationary market condition is going to have a large impact on that as well. Next area is interest rate analysis, and obviously, when we're looking at interest rates, we're looking at higher interest rates. Have we seen a trend in interest rates? Have we been climbing? Are we looking at lower interest rates? Have we just had rates decrease, or have we seen a trend in lower interest rates? Or do we have unexpected change? Something coming out with you know, FOMC that the currency came out and intervene in the currency by having unexpected interest rate change. Did they hike interest rates, or did they do an unexpected rate cut? And also, by looking at interest rates, which is not noted here, we look at differentials between two interest rate markets, so between a currency that has a high interest rate and a low interest rate. Many times, that's what's called a carrying change charge market, where you can actually have a very easy way of finding trade threshold when it has that. But again, you know, we're looking at these two primary areas of focus on the perspective. We have the macro market analysis, and the inflation market, and interest rates alignment with that perspective, and that will give us our picture analysis numbers that frame when the grand scale, are we buy or sell, and we're primarily on that. Next area is market analysis. And then by the CRE index, we're focusing primarily on the commodity market. And we're looking at the relationship between commodities and the US dollar index. You see many times the markets between commodities and dollar index are inversely related. In other words, if the dollar index is going up, usually commodity prices are going down. And when prices are going up, usually the dollar is going higher. And vice versa. Again, looking at these three areas of study, we need two of these areas of study to come to agreement to arrive at our big picture perspective. Okay, we can see an interest rate market indicating that there are lower rates on the horizon or higher interest rates on the horizon. And that's not, you know, blending well to the directional bias on a currency. And if we see that same time happening where the commodity market wants to go higher and the dollar index wants to go lower, that gives us a framework for high reward trade scenario relative to the picture. So only when we're now three areas of study. Okay, and that's already. But what we say high reward trade setup is if your big picture perspective, your intermediate perspective, and your short perspective is all in agreement. Okay, directional bias is going to be marketplace, that is how your trade scenarios work to us. And last and four is seasonal influences, and that is obviously you know, seeking in terms of are we in a seasonal tendency for the asset class or pair or currency, or for the dollar for that matter, or commodities. And if you're studying commodities, it's a large seasonal influence that has an effect on commodities. And we see that, obviously, it's going to be mirrored in what we see in the dollar index. Okay, if the CRE index is entering, time and commodities as a whole usually go higher, that's going to put down pressure on the dollar. So if you're down pressure on the dollar, that means that we can see easy buy signals in currencies that have interest rates that are going higher, and that chasing of yield, okay, with the currency makes a high reward trade up. And obviously, there's a bear seasonal tendency as well. But when we go forward in the membership, we're going to break down what specifically frames the inflationary market and deflationary market, and how do we look at interest rates specifically, and how to use the interest rate market for timing. So we get a stage on when this criteria is in place, what we do with it, you know, when should we be buying or selling relative to the interest rate analysis we see. And same thing with market analysis and seasonal tendencies.
So to be honest, I have never used any of these. For me personally, I think this falls underneath fundamentals, which is just kind of news or economic events that can affect the markets. Although these things can affect the markets, usually for me, I am just a price action trader, reading what price is currently giving me, especially from an intraday perspective. So although these things can have effects on the market from a macro perspective, a bigger picture perspective, ultimately, all I really care about, hey, what is London doing today? How can I profit? What is New York doing today? How can I profit and capitalize on this move? So I have never used any of these things, but maybe it could help me out, and I am interested in hearing more about this.
You are buying or selling relative to the interest rate analysis, and same thing with market analysis and seasonal tendencies. And the focus is obviously the intermediate perspective, and it is by way of looking at the top-down analysis, the metrics data, and market sentiment. And from any perspective, there's only really three things to look for, okay, but at least two of these things have to come in agreement. So that means by looking at these three specific components, okay, top-down analysis is looking at high time frame, lower time frame, and CFT, again, if you're not familiar with that, it's going to be a metrics data. What we do is look at the CFTC report, and gives us a reportable level report on large commercial traders, large speculators, and obviously small specs. We're always looking at small specs. Small specs, we like ourselves, new and trading in unreportable levels. If we want to trade, hello, we have to report our trade size, which is mandated by CFTC, at least in the States. And the market sentiment is simply IG market name, okay, which is a measure of broker transactions calling around and getting a consensus on whether they believe a particular market is bullish or bearish. And it's basically an opinion. You can use other things like certain websites out there that have a bullish or bearish opinion. Like you go to barchart.com, you go to assess a commodity, you can see what the community at large in that forum has for that particular view. I think pretty much just every forum out there has a way of measuring sentiment. And I do a lot of research on Saturdays with that perspective alone. I go through a lot of resources not to show you where I go get all my sentiment numbers. But again, this teaching is not going to teach you everything about every individual component, but the components that we're talking about specifically laying down the foundation. It's important that we know where our site is going to focus on through this membership and why it's not a lot of information. But it's a little bit of homework that's needed for you to get to the decision-making process that I go through as a trader. So again, let's take a closer look at these three things.
For me, I am very familiar with the top-down analysis. I basically do that every single day and week on the charts. I have never seen the COT data or the market sentiment numbers, so hopefully that will be something that could potentially help me out in the future. Also, keep in mind, if you are a newer trader trying to absorb all this information, just know that you don't need every single thing that he's going to teach. Pick and choose what is beneficial for you and helps you in your trading. But once again, it is not all needed, so don't feel too overwhelmed. A lot of new things are being thrown at you, but don't get too afraid by seeing all these things and you're already kind of struggling to read the charts as it is, and now you're going to have to go online and read numbers and things like that. Remember, it is not needed.
Okay, so any perspective on the marketplace between high reward trading scenarios or setups? Okay, top-down analysis is obviously going through a monthly chart, and we do monthly chart analysis, and we're specifically looking for a monthly chart. Obviously, I don't need to read detail, I'm not trying to teach you all here. The monthly chart is looking at key levels, looking at intermediate and long-term highs and lows, looking at specific four blocks.
You can afford every kitchen knife. I found before. It's a Japanese chef's knife that's made thousands of reviews from top chefs.
Blocks, and we're looking at levels that show a clear indication of wanting to repel price higher or lower. And same thing said for the weekly chart. When we look at the weekly chart, we're looking at a higher time frame perspective. So it gives a great deal framework for high reward trading scenarios because of the weekly chart being, again, over the chart. Large funds, okay, large managed funds, do a great deal analysis on weekly charts. Okay, most of their work really comes by way of monthly and weekly, and they usually execute on daily charts. Okay, so it's important that you understand that that's the reason why the markets move around like they do. Most folks that have YouTube channels and Facebook accounts that are out there trying to pretend that they're some kind of analysis or analyst or teacher, they'll be teaching what they want in chart, five chart, and they lead individuals to believe that these intraday charts have some influence on price. They don't. They're only reflecting, okay, what is going to be arrived at by looking at monthly, weekly, daily chart, because those three time frames are really what makes the markets move. By having these in your perspective, okay, again, you have to have at least two of these areas of focus in agreement. So you could have an idea on a monthly chart that frames one of the two things that lead to your intermediate term perspective. Okay, and it could be obviously off the weekly chart or the daily chart. Okay, that would be one of the two that's necessary to frame your intermediate perspective. The next area is going to be a CFT data. Okay, that's obviously looking at the bullish hedging by smart money or commercial traders, or the bearish hedging by smart money. Again, if you haven't watched any market tutorials, there's teaching for commercial traders. It's important to know that you'll learn everything you need to know about CFT data in this membership. So even if you haven't watched the videos, okay, or familiar with commercial traders, just settle down, relax, please don't send me up a Twitter storm of questions or email, because everything I'm talking about here, I'm laying down a foundation. Okay, these are the things that you need to start to write down in your notebook, because there's going to be areas in your notebook that you need to have specific notes relative to these things. Okay, and I'll give you everything you need to know and more. Trust me, I'm just giving you the foundation where our study is going forward by going into this membership. And obviously with the CFT data, we look at extreme levels historically in the last 12 months and the last 4 years, when the commercials on the commercial report get to a 12-month extreme, higher or low. In other words, they have a real extreme high reading or low reading relative to net sums that are aligned to this used for CFT net trade position chart, which I'm all about. That usually sometimes indicates a change in trading program and gives you a real clear indication that's probably an internal high point. And last is market sentiment. Obviously, we're looking at extreme market bullishness or extreme market bearishness. And again, that's one of the things, by the way, my Saturday, I go through all the things that lead to my opinion for my individual market sentiment readings based on a number of areas I go and look for readings, and I get an average of reading and come with a consensus or not, where you have a bullish or bearish sentiment. Again, at these three, you have these two in agreement. The least of significance is obviously market sentiment. But the main thing is, the top analysis, you have to have a level or an idea relative to the monthly, weekly, or daily. It does not require two of those time frames. It just needs one. Okay? You can trade really without the monthly, weekly, daily chart and trade on a idea relative to the commercial and sentiment. Like that. You're probably going to use the daily chart, the chart, the monthly chart. Yeah, you can, but you can still use the commercial data, information we provide to you, and market sentiment to frame your intermediate perspective. Now, obviously, we're not executing on any basis, but it frames your trade idea. You need one of two, at least three, to come in agreement with your intermediate perspective. Now, I know some of you are thinking, well, what if I look at monthly chart and tell me this is bullish, and weekly chart is bearish, and daily chart is bearish? If the commercial says it's bullish, and market sentiment is extremely bullish, okay, we'll do all that. How do I write that? That's all I'm going to talk to you in the membership. But the main thing is, this criteria is what we'll be using going forward. So when we look at the market and these views, you understand why I'm doing what I'm doing, because it's based on the things you're saying here. Okay, so again, just know that that's your perspective outline. They come to an agreement with at least two of these areas of study or focus for your perspective. You have to come to an agreement with two of them. Remember, you have to be a buyer based on two specific areas of study here out of the three. Okay, so again, as an example, the weekly chart indicates high prices, and commentators are suggesting that there's bullishness on the stance of commercials. That would be enough to frame a intermediate term perspective. That means you have to be around for short term perspective that lines up with mine. And that's really, all we do here. That's all we're doing. That's what we're going to frame a macro big perspective, okay, and an intermediate term perspective, and a short term perspective. That's what we'll look at next. Okay, so for short term perspectives, we're looking at the correlation analysis, time and price theory, and IFTA, which is again interbank price theory algorithm. So take a close look at this short term perspective. It's right there to be something staring at you that now also means look at three things to arrive at our short-term perspective. And the reason why is because most people just look at one chart or another chart and say, okay, well, this is all I need, and that's what gets in trouble. Okay, so short-term perspectives. Okay, we're looking at the correlation analysis, and again, that is going to be linked to your understanding of the U.S. dollar index S&P analysis, and that's probably when way over your head if you're new to the market controls, that probably sounds like something from NASA. But the dollar index S&P analysis is basically just looking at the relationship between the dollar making higher highs, a relationship between a currency to the dollar, like the British pound, for instance, if the dollar making higher highs, if the British pound versus the dollar fails to make lower lows, that's a correct correlation. We view that with a specific idea in mind. And the other correlation analysis concept that I use is correlated pair S&P analysis, where we look at closely correlated pairs, like for instance, the euro dollar and the British pound dollar, because usually moving in general same direction, not always obviously because it's a price issue. Generally, when there's a symmetrical market, we learned that in this membership already, correlated pairs move in tandem. When they do not move in tandem, that obviously gives us a lot of insight in terms of how we should trade marketplace. If it is not moving in tandem, then obviously that's an indication that we do not have what asymmetrical markets. So that means we have to be very selective with trade, because now there's a lack of symmetry in markets. That means the dollar is very clearly moving higher, all foreign currencies are moving lower in sympathy. Next area study is time and price theory. Okay, so time and price theory, we're looking specifically.
So at the short-term perspective, this is something that I'm more well-versed in when it comes to the USD SMT analysis. To be honest, I have not used SMT. If he is referring to SMT divergence, I know some people can refer to SMT as something else, but I believe in this one, talking about divergences and comparing two markets, two charts, and helping, or by seeing one chart do something, it could definitely help you understand what the other chart is most likely going to do. The only way I have used it, as he expressed, with Euro USD and GBP USD, usually they move symmetrical with each other. And usually when I see some type of discrepancy of one going higher and one going lower, I can kind of get a feel for what one is going to do before it actually does it, because I know that when there is a discrepancy, one is basically ahead of the other, or one is about to reverse and get back in line with the other. But ultimately, there are still things that I can learn, especially with the divergence, and these are some good concepts that I would recommend.
At the quarterly effect, every 3 months or so, there's a new price shift in the higher time frame, the market's going higher. Generally, you obviously, the consolidation for the next 3 months, not for the next entire 3 months, but over the course of 3 months, as the market's going higher, you obviously see the consolidation or reverse, okay? And the market's going lower, okay? Over the next 3 months, we may see consolidation and go to the range, or it could reverse to higher. We're watching the market over, if you just 3 or 4 months, so a little bit of overlap in terms of calendar months, not specific daily, not specific to the first of every month to the end of, the last day of the third month. It's not that clear cut, so we look at the market with a quarterly perspective and allow the next shift in market structure to unfold. There's a monthly effect, we look at the monthly ranges and look at the specific points of reference relative to the monthly chart. And then obviously weekly ranges, we know about that, as I teach a lot in my tutorials about one shot one kill setups, which I think is like, I think my bread and butter go-to. That's how I define my own trading. I'm a weekly range trader by far and large. That's usually how I'm trading the market, I'm looking for capitalizing at least a lion's portion of what I interpret as a weekly range that may unfold before we get ahead. And obviously the daily range. Daily range is the time price theory that we use for engineering daily range, the power tree. You'll have a close, how that transforms into the actual daily candle. Those theories and ideas concepts, we'll teach a great deal about that. And obviously time of day, we'll build on what I've shared in free tutorials, and actually have really precision-based concepts as it relates to that. And finally, EFTA, which is the price theory algorithm, will be.
For me personally, I've definitely focused more on the daily range and time of day. As an intraday trader, I'm really just trying to get in and out of a trade. I think having the higher time frame perspective can definitely help you out as a swing trader, or just even have a better general idea of what price is most likely going to do in the long run, and hopefully that'll help with your intraday perspectives. But for me, I'm just trying to get in for a couple hours and get out, so I don't really care about the higher time frames, but I'm sure they're very beneficial, and I'm sure there's some things that I could definitely learn in this realm here.
Nailing down institutional order flow, I understand, obviously, by looking at liquidity. We're looking at how market seeks liquidity, and we'll be finishing up our perspective on market efficiency paradigm. So when we look at the short-term perspective, we require three things, okay? Three things must come by these 3 areas, like correlation analysis, time price theory, and the EFTA. Preferably, you have to have at least one from each, okay? So you have to have your dollar index is giving you an indication that it's showing you correct correlation, or correlated pair efficiency is giving you insight, okay? So that'll be one way of determining correlation analysis. The next area is crucial time price. You have to have something from time price theory to indicate where you're at relative to short-term perspective. Now you're probably thinking, well, how is the quarterly effect and monthly effect or weekly range short-term perspective? Because short-term is what you're asking next to, okay? Doesn't mean this is your final payment setup. This is your short-term perspective. So we're looking at framing the ideas of trading around big picture perspective, intermediate-term perspective, and short-term perspective. When we get things in alignment that lead to us being a buyer all across those three perspectives, being a big picture perspective, intermediate-term perspective, and short-term perspective, we are highly prepared to find high reward setups to be a buyer in these conditions. Doesn't mean you have no losses and you have all wins. That doesn't mean that, okay? But we have a context that we frame our ideas of trades with that model, or at least that's how I do it. So if you're hearing my ideas, we can have the correlated analysis give us the indication that we're going to be bullish on dollar, which would be bearish on foreign currencies, and time price theory, okay? Correlated effect, maybe we've seen the market moving higher, okay, in recent months, and we're probably going to go into a down cycle, okay? And that would lend well to you being short on foreign currencies. Maybe the weekly range, okay? Maybe we have initially been a weekly rally up from Sunday and Monday, and now we're primarily looking for lower prices. And if we see that weakness on the part of foreign currencies relative to dollar index suggesting, okay, these are scenarios I'm getting, just, and I guess some of your practice is too big, it's not helpful. Okay, believe me, this is what really training is all about. You're doing all these things behind the scenes. The very little bit of time that's used to execute trades, okay, that's so tiny. The most of your time is actually in the process of deciding whether you should be better or better, and what frames that criteria. And obviously, time of day, are we in a time of day where it's conducive to the setup, okay? We may not have any immediate off the quarterly effect or monthly effect, or weekly range or daily range, okay? But the time of day may indicate that now something there is something that we can do, okay? And obviously, that is always going to be essential. Understanding institutional order flow and understanding where liquidity is and why the market will seek that liquidity. And our perspective is always with the market efficiency paradigm. We look at the marketplace in terms of where are the orders. It's not the orders of smart money, okay? Like supply and demand tries to teach you that this is where smart money orders are, this is where smart money wants to go back to. They're not always doing that. They're sometimes seeking where existing orders are that will allow them to engineer counterparties to their execution, okay? So in other words, they'll run old highs for the buy stops, they'll run old lows for the sell stops, because that will be a forced injection of liquidity to the counterparty to their bookmaking. So we're going to go forward in our studies and this mentorship with a great deal of refining on all these things. And I know some of you probably looked at this as well.
This is a big part of smart money concepts. The idea is the banks are the ones in control of the market, and it is ran off of an algorithm. So if we understand how the algorithm works, specifically with these three things, this will definitely be beneficial for our trading.
This is a lot of just more information, but I have to give you a context of where our area of study is going to be. So in the grand scheme of things, we're going to break the market down in these specific perspectives, and then what we do in these respective areas of study that give us what we're specifically doing on the daily basis. Now, it looks like, and I talked for a long time, it looks like a lot of information and a lot of things to do to become aware of what the buyers are. You'll see, obviously, the big picture perspective usually have that at the end of the week, and the intermediate perspective usually have that at the end of the week. It happens or change here in the middle of the week, relative to Tuesday, Wednesday, but usually the short-term perspective, that's the one that usually changes on a day-by-day basis. Okay, so I understand that while we do a lot of homework in the big picture perspective and intermediate perspective, we do that on weekends, your nightly or daily procedures will be largely in this list that you see right here. So when we do like live sessions, okay, I'm operating from this scale right here. I'm looking for three things to come in agreement, and that's why when I call this a moving marketplace, they usually go there, and I'm using this right here. They are all linked to my understanding of what I arrived at from my intermediate perspective and my big picture perspective, okay? But once you understand price action extremely well, and you operate as a scalper, okay, and I'm not trying to induce the notion of scalping as an idea of trading, I just want you to take my information and do that very early, you can just use what you see here, and you can be a very efficient scalper if you understand what is being shown here and what specifically the view of this information. You understand what correlation is, what monthly effect is, what the range of range time of day. Understanding what S&P versus correlation versus understanding what crack means for you as a trader. And obviously understanding institutional where it stops and why the stops would be necessarily upper grass, why the market doesn't have to be on this. So again, this is the only thing that you need to be worrying about in terms of trade plan development for IC mentorship. All these things come by way of very, very short amount of time, looking at price, and you'll come away with what you want to do right away. And initially, you're going to write down these things. I believe that the picture perspective is, I believe it's going to be this, this, and this. And then you're going to get a return perspective, you come away with your analysis on what you believe there. And when you see short perspective, you go through the same process here. Basically, what you saw me doing with the exception of not bringing up the S&P versus studies in September, because I was looking at what you didn't see. I was operating this short-term perspective. That's how, this is my model, okay? So as a trader, this short-term trader, and it's a much one-kill trader, this is all the information I need. I don't need anything else outside this page you're looking at here. I need three things to come in agreement with that. And I understand where short-term perspective is, where the market's going to go. And that's why I'm like 90% accurate. And in the month of September, we've been able to 100% accurate. We're going to ask the market to show us in terms of where it's going to go and why we're doing it. It's not always going to be that easy to make transitions, obviously, on a mid-term basis, on a long-term basis. And that will cause you to have hiccups, okay? Or speed bumps, if you will, barriers, okay? On these short-term perspectives, and that's where the losses are going to be. You're going to find that your losses are not incurred so much by way of trading in the long-term perspective picture. When you're trading those higher time frames, those trades.
Right, I'm about to share a really big secret. You see, this BMW was actually traded in on a Ferrari.
And it generally will serve you very well. You will still have losses, but you'll find that all of your trades that have the majority of the losing side is going to be because you're in a short-term perspective and you force something for the market transition and you have to allow for that. Okay, so if you're focusing on high-frame perspective in your trades, that is an advantage. So while we see the operating model picking a time frame in the 4-hour and 1-hour chart, the things that we talk about are largely limited to the chart. If we do that, primarily all our trade setups requiring a bigger perspective and a major perspective and a short-term perspective. In alignment, agreement, and all three, we come away with a reason for expecting the outcome, no higher prices, for lower prices. The thing we have here, we have to have seven things in agreement to make a high reward trade scenario. Okay, for a high reward trade setup, it has to be four things in agreement. That means you have to have two things in agreement from the big picture perspective. You have two things in agreement with the intermediate term perspective. Then you have to have all three. Listen, listen here. You have to have one from each one of these three to come in agreement with all three perspectives, big picture, intermediate term perspective, and short term perspective. And if you frame your trades with this mindset, what that does is, number one, it gives you clarity. Number one, it gives you understanding what it is you should be expecting in the market and why, which is important. Okay, it's not important to understand every dynamic behind what's being shown here for each perspective of the market. That's what we taught you. But understanding that you need to have seven things, okay, seven things that build high reward trade setups. This is not execution, this is not entry. It just gives you the framework what makes that trade high probability or basically high reward. You still have to wait for a entry signal. And again, that's the least of your concern right now. So that's what I'm saying. I look at this information, because even when I'm going to read about each individual component, you can see clearly that there is a method behind what I do. Okay, folks that are on the outside, they look at what I do, and they say, well, there's no real structure, there's no real plan of action, there's no way of knowing what it's actually doing from beginning to end, and that is because they have not been exposed to what they're being exposed to now. There is a method, there is a rhythm, there's a routine that you go through, but it has to come by way of the process-oriented thinking. And this is how I break the market down, this is how I internalize it, and I go through the process of going through these three perspectives, and by doing that, it gives me everything I need in terms of arriving at a decision. And once you have that same process of thinking, okay, you have no problem going through marketplace finding scenarios and setups and thinking out what gives you your unique trade setup that you like to trade, that you find very easy, and the clarity will be exactly as you imagine it would be. And you get in front of the chart, it just jumps off at you. Okay, that's how it'll be for you. And you're sure, you don't get exposed to these types of thinking. You don't get exposed to these process, procedures where you have to look at things conceptually. Because number one, it doesn't solve courses. It doesn't make you want to watch that YouTube video. You don't want to listen to this one. Okay, but this is where the real meat is. Okay, you have to know why these things make a difference and why it's important to understand what you need to be doing for individual perspectives of study. And then once you go through and understand it, it's like anything else. No one wants to read the driver's manual to drive. No one wants to look at the instruction manual and have that TV stand together. You buy your basic habit. Okay, you don't look at parts of the through it. You can't do that trading. Okay, you have to go through this boring stuff, and it means a great deal. Trust me. If I wouldn't hold this initially, I would ignore it too. I would just push
so far, he hasn't gone into depth exactly what each and every one of these things are. I'm sure later on in the course he will, but ultimately he is just describing or telling us that there has to be certain components that lead to high reward trading setups. They don't always have to be the exact same, but there has to be a handful or a certain number. I know he's pointing out seven here, but obviously it kind of can be up to you if you want 8 or 6 or 4 or 10, whatever it is. Having those things line up will give you those high reward setups. So don't feel overwhelmed now. He isn't going over in detail what these things are. In the future, we will. But just understand that to find these high reward setups, there has to be a select few of things that align to give you that setup.
That's how I thought too. Once I felt the pain of not knowing what I was doing, then I suddenly got interested in what makes traders think the way they do. And then what's the process? Why do they think the way they think? And why do they build a trading plan around that? What do you not see in the marketplace? When people sell things and they sell courses and stuff, do they don't sell? They never sell you an actual trading plan. They never sell you a step-by-step, this is what you're going to do, and this is the reason why you should do this. None of that. That was my goal for this mentorship. I'm going to show you what specifically I do as a trader. Now, I'm going to give you all kinds of ideas on how you can find that and make it yours, and you find your own trading model around that. Because I believe, the first story you said, man, you can't copy someone else, you can't do it. And some of you want to be just like me as a trader, then you just do that. You're only asking me to call moves and trade the levels like I call them. So it's not too much trading. You want to have the ability to reinterpret the same idea, and that's what you're going to pay for, and that's what you're going to get as a delivery. And this mentorship, you have everything I do. Why I do what I do, and how I understand, is with this engineer. There's no secret sauce, there's nothing outside with this engineer. The theory behind why all blend together, okay? That's what we'll be building on. And once we understand intimately what each one of these perspectives we're looking for, and what criteria blends well for the decision making process for each individual perspective and individual perspective component. Once we have that, then we have the building blocks for what? The flowchart for every model trading that can be. Day trade, scalping, swing trading, much on kill, even position trading. All those things, it's easy for me to have a flowchart and say, okay, XYZ, do this, do that. You'll know what I mean by that. That's why I said, I have a flowchart on the website right now. You wouldn't be able to do anything with it. It would be no use to you. You couldn't do anything with it. But by bringing these individual components, intimately, you'll know what I mean when I say, okay, do this or do that. Okay, you'll be my job, and I know how to arrive at the decision relative to this specific point of reference. And by doing that, you'll work through the flowchart and you'll come to the decision point where you take action, where you stand, and you wait for more information. It's basically binary. You need to trade just like that. It's boring. It's exactly what you want. You do not want high cycle in your trade. Only do that when you get really good discipline. That's when you're about. But throughout the week, when you're not still trading, you cannot allow your business to get crazy. And you want to trade boring. You want to be monotonous. You want to be mundane and routine and nothing exciting about it. That's when you know you're not forced by emotion. You know, you're talking about your greed. It's the same all the time. You hear something like I'm talking. I'll talk about this. I'm going to start screaming. I'm not worrying about it. It's the same times. The whole time the room is lit up. I can't see this happening. You're all experiencing that for the first time. You're experiencing something on a basis. That's not something I'm excited about unless I see a real nutrient. When you get in and response to that, but when we go through the process of breaking down markets and looking at high reward trade scenarios, you have to suppress that desire. Don't be rushed to that feeling. You're right, but don't do that. And having a process of thinking, you're thinking minor. It's X or so. It's owner of the black or white. That's how you can see. And if you work your model into that area of study and execution, you have no problem with your greed. You won't rush. You won't change it all. As I mentioned in the previous teaching, you have a loss. It's not worry about it. It's very easy to bet. And even if you're losing, it doesn't take long to do that. But if you lose your mind, okay, and all of a sudden markets are going to work again, you're going to think that way. You'll see by this membership, you know everything you know. And operating excuse me, you're not going to be right. And you'll know exactly what you're going to do and why. But it comes out with this right here. And I'll frame this. Nothing outside this. No secret stuff. Okay. Everything we find, the great detail, minor detail, and what it allows us to do is to have specific processes that will lend well to specific conditions we'll talk about. And all that we'll start to experience. But the ingredient behind all this is what's shown here in this tutorial. And it's important to understand this is exactly what you would be wanting to know if you didn't know it. And it doesn't sound sexy. It doesn't make a good course. It doesn't make a good video to YouTube. If if you were to just explain this, it's almost a service to DFI on this point of view. It's telling me nothing. But really, it's a real business. It's exactly the thing for the lack of a trade. How many local markets and why they go over here, how should we make a month, you know, the maximum for our store. All that is going to be shown here in my implementation of all that information. So I'm just saying that we're going to build this individually, conceptually, and it must be first of all, it'll be easy to be able to provide DFI, and you know exactly what that means. Look at DFI, why these information reference points are influential in terms of decision making. Once you have that, you exactly what you're trying to work. And then making efficient
trade. Okay, folks, welcome back. This is lesson 7 of 8 of the second month of mentorship. We're going to be specifically dealing with the marketing trap of false flags. Now, a false flag, okay, is basically a pattern that classic chartists and pure chart pattern traders will fall victim to a lot. Early on in my career, I fell victim to this particular pattern as well, because as a new trader, being introduced to markets and the commodity market, the class I started with was the commodity market. My way of introduction came by way of Ken Roberts, and one of the patterns that he taught in his manual, the world's most powerful manual, I wasn't supposed to say that, but it did introduce me to technical analysis, and one of the patterns that studying classic chart patterns is a continuation pattern. And one of the simplest to see in price action is a bull flag, but unfortunately, not all sudden price rallies that move into short-term consolidation are bull flags. And if you don't know what a bull flag is, don't worry, I'm going to give you an example of what they are. But for now, for the point of concern, we have an immature bull trend, or in higher time frame distribution levels, price will post, or create, or print, if you will, in our charts, a false bull flag. Now, retail traders, and I'm referring to myself when I first started as a commodity trader, I saw this as a classic continuation buy pattern, but it many times resulted in a reversal. As time went on, my understanding grew, I discerned that understanding higher time frame charts and what you know now as a premium market, they assist me in understanding and identifying potentially bearish bull flags. In other words, a typical bull flag would indicate a pause or midway point, but another leg higher, or basically a traditional ABCD pattern. And it's a measure move type phenomenon in price action. But I found that I would fall victim to this simply because I was only looking for patterns for the sake of patterns. Price does not move based on any kind of pattern, whether it be a order block or mitigation block or breaker or even class patterns, edge orders, or in this case, a bull flag. Now, obviously, the opposite side of the spectrum and more bearish in a continuation pattern and a nice strong trend, you'll see a quick sudden move lower, a small consolidation, and another equal leg lower. Perhaps a small consolidation. I cannot give you some examples when we get past this one part. But not all sudden price declines that move to short term consolidation are bear flags. And obviously, in short bear trends or in higher time accumulation levels, price will post false bear flags. And obviously, retail traders will use the classic continuation sell pattern, but many times it will reverse. And again, take away some higher time frame charts and understand discount markets will assist in identifying when these are potentially false bear flags or when not to expect another leg lower, but in fact, a lie.
So what I'm assuming here is ICT is going to show us how to properly interpret these flag patterns. If you are a new trader or have traded in the past, you probably have came across any type of pattern recognition strategy. And of course, flag patterns are going to be one of them. To be honest, I have never dove deep into patterns of that sort. But either way, I'm assuming he's just going to show us how flag patterns actually cause or actually are manipulation patterns for retail traders to be used as liquidity to go into the direction that the banks want to take the market into. But we'll see what he breaks down here.
I would not expect another leg lower, but in fact, bye. Yes, so for those that are unaware of what their flag or bull flag is, this is basically the practice that I've seen in Google on bull flag, and this is one that came up that I agree with in terms of what it explains on how the price action should be viewed. Generally, you'll see a price leg up, and then there'll be a small consolidation. That consolidation can go sideways, or in this case, it'll be slightly slanted lower, and also there'll be another impulse on higher that would be equal to the first impulse on higher. So you have a measure move. The reason why I call these patterns bull flags is the first leg up in price. That would be viewed as the flag hole, okay? So the reason why I'm saying that way. And then the flag portion is that small consolidation slanting lower, and then they would measure that flag hole on the first leg up, and then add that to the move out of the consolidation, and that would be your measure move. And while when I first started, I can admit to you some of my grain trades and some of my live cattle and live hog trades on straight commodities.
So from a very basic standpoint, he's showing the basic flag pattern. You have the first move up, price moves sideways, even slightly angles itself downwards, and then you have a second push up. And usually that first push up will be mimicked on that second push up. So for example, if you have a 50 pip move to the upside, when you get that second burst or that second upwards move, after price has consolidated, it should also be about 50 pips as well.
They came by way of trading this pattern here. It happened to occur when I had 1 hour's past six divergence, and I was agreement with rate. Problem is, I never really considered the time frame chart, or what I understand now as being more discount market. Obviously, the same thing can be said in reverse for bear flags. Then you'll see a market drop off, a sudden decline.
Same thing, but flip for the bearish flag.
Consolidation sideways, or in this case, could be a consolidation that slopes up diagonally, and then another leg equal to the first price, slightly impulse lower. That measurement, when that first leg lower, if you add it to, I'm sorry, you subtract it to, rather, the breakout high, and consolidation, that would be your projected low. And again, when markets are in a nice strong trend and not mature, and they still have more legs to go lower, okay, this pattern is pretty consistent. Problem is, when you're not aware when the trend is mature, or where you're in areas of accumulation, in other words, the markets will come under aggressive buying, less not buying, these patterns will materialize near the low, and you'll see a lot of folks see this as a continuation pattern. You'll see on Twitter, you'll see on social media, that there'll be a particular expectation to see new leg lower in price, but many times it won't go down, or it does, it's going to be a smaller bit, and then reverse abruptly go higher. Now, looking at another Google example, okay, to give you a little more framework, these are not my charts, I just grab them off of Google. You can actually do Google searches on your own, get a little more examples of what a bull flag and a bear flag look like in price action. But I like this one here just for a quick an idea of what we would be looking for in order to flag measurement would be and adding to or subtracting from that consolidation deal as a price target. That's right, while I'm not trying to teach you this thing, it's obviously pretty general knowledge, I want to teach you how the markets can actually give us these false patterns and we take advantage of that. So here we have a classic setup where the market has moved up aggressively, suddenly moved up higher, and we have a small consolidation as an immediate rally up higher. When we see that, obviously the first thing that comes to mind, if you know what a bull flag pattern is, well, this is obviously a bull flag. And you would measure the flag hole or the impulse price up, and then you would add that to the consolidation area, and you would give you a projected high. So we expect reasonably for just pattern trading, continuation classic patterns, if you will, we would look for higher prices. The problem is, if we're just looking at one time frame and just only focusing there, that's the problem. You have to have a certain measure of top-down analysis, and using our time frame charts, monthly, weekly, daily, and at least a 4-hour, but preferably a daily chart, that will give us the indications that there's going to be a little more information that needs to be considered. So when we see that, clearly it's viewed as a classic bull flag. Okay? And if we were going back in time machine, if someone would have given me this chart in my first 6-8 months of trading, I clearly would have expected this market to go higher based on just this simple pattern one. And unfortunately, like I said in the past, when I first started trading, everything was in a bull market. And I can understand buying low, sell high, and never understood rather the concept of selling short. My first year couldn't grasp it, so I would only be a buyer. But I can tell you, as an intro, my first year, I would look at this and consider this a bull flag. Problem is, that's what we'd end up having. So clearly, we see that this bull flag was the opposite. It gave us no advance higher. It only gave us this breach above a previous area of consolidation. So let's take a look about this specific area and what was behind the scenes that led to this overall price reversal. Okay, let's take a closer look at this particular false flag. Okay, we have price showing a clear classic bull pattern in here, bullish flag. But what would cause this market breakdown? Like that? Why did it not continue and make its equal leg up here, add to the move up? Why didn't the measurement higher? And again, why did the bull flag fail? Well, let's take a look at things a little closer. Let's focus primarily on the bodies of the candles and the price action first. this way for a second. Okay, and we're primarily at the body of the candle. Right here. As price dropped lower, we rallied up, tried to go a little lower again, and finally ran through. Everybody, the trade will fly, so they're excited about this move here breaking out. Now they did a trade just above this old high. Okay. If we were going to use this area right here, we're gonna move that and shade it within near the highlight. And we're gonna go out to the daily chart. Okay, so we have the daily chart here, and what we look at is the price swing from this high down, and then we retrace it up. So as price was running up in that blue shade area, we had only a 15 minute time frame. We're inside of this big up candle, which is a bearish order block. And we also have, if we take our fib and we draw from the high down to the low right here, which is right before this price went up, we can clearly see that we are in.
So if you didn't catch what he's saying so far, basically right now we're on 1218. Let's go back. Basically, he's saying at this point in time, if you only looked at this specific time frame, this looks like a classic bull flag. You have that big push up, you have the sideways movement with a slight downward angle, and now you're anticipating this to be a continuation move and another big push to the upside. And if this move here was 50 pips, you probably anticipate another 50 pip move to the upside. At this point in time, if you're looking at it from a very simplistic perspective, that is what you believe. But as you see, price does not do that. And what he's saying is we need to use, or you can use the bull flag pattern, but you also need to understand where price is relative to the higher time frame, building that story, building that bias to figure out what price is more likely to do. So here, the reason why price did not go higher is because when we zoom out to the higher time frame, and actually before I go there, he is also describing how these wicks formed. For example, seeing this big spike to the upside and then closing lower is a potential sign that price does not want to go higher. That's one thing. And then two, he also points out as price pushes on up, takes out this high, this is probably that first sign from a classic bullish flag perspective. If you are trading that perspective, that people will start to look at this as the second push up, place a buy because this high was broken, and then have a stop loss probably somewhere down here. So here, watch how price closed, and also watch how price is faking out those retail traders. And as we continue to move forward, he's pointing out,
we have price.
He is pointing out the higher time frame perspective here. And first, he pointed out the bearish engulfing order block. This is the last buy move before price sold off. So price is tapping into this order block, and right now it looks like he's going to pull out his fib to show you that price is also in premium as well.
If we take our fib and we draw from the high down to the low right here, which is right before this price went up, we clearly see that we are in an area of distribution, and what that means is we are in an area of premium. So all through here, the market is in a premium market relative to the range of this old high, this old low. So what we know about the market now, we're dropped down into a 4-hour chart, so focusing primarily here. And when we look at this down move in here, we have a rally up, creating a liquidity void, and then we have another liquidity void going down. Midway through that, it's going to be the equivalent of what would be viewed as a bearish order block. So since we're in a premium market, where we should be seeing distribution, we have two areas in which the market created liquidity voids, running up and running down. This entire range, okay, is going to be viewed in the scope of a bearish order block, so we'll be looking at like a mean threshold. If we drop down into a 1-hour chart, okay, so we have price coming down, and right in here, we're going to look at a little more detail by dropping down into a 15-minute time frame, okay? We have a gap between opening this candle and closing this candle right in here, okay? So we're going to focus primarily on that. We're going to zoom in on a 5-minute chart, so we're fine. And you see this one up candle prior to the down move here, and there's two candles going up right before the move lower. And this up move here was up candle one and two. That one trades right back up into the institutional order of this low here and this low here. The low in this candle comes in at 7714. The high comes in at 7714. So closing the liquidity void in here, relative to what was offered, the market was posting most prices offering higher for the buy side. When it got down through it, they offered it one more time here to be sold, filling that range. So from this low over here, cut through this candle, and you'll see the axi, it's filling that range. So we have one, two candles. If you take those two candles and you measure that range from the body, low to the body high, between two candles, you get equilibrium here, which is that level I highlighted. We saw the bottom of that last up candle on a 5-minute time frame. So that's why that level's here. Okay, so by having that level, and also unframing this swing high here, so we have a little bit of a fair value gap right there. You can see price creating this potential bull flag here. And start to come up. What's it really doing? It's only clearing out the bodies of the candles over here. And this big wick that we saw in the time frame is not being considered at all. But when price starts to break down, all we have to do is go back in and look at price action here. Look at the up candles. Okay, the up candles are the bodies and the wicks on the low end. That's where all the sensitivity on the short will be. So when we get into areas of heavy distribution like this, and we see a quick rally up and consolidation, or it's like dropping lower, which would look like a bull flag, we don't see that as a bullish scenario. What we're doing is we're looking for to create a false move and break lower. Now, one, two scenarios can happen. One, you can get a turtle soup scenario where it'll start to come up, okay, and then start to break down. That's the easiest one to trade because you'll have to see it go up. If you trade up, it's a turtle soup scenario where it'll start to come up, okay, and then start to break down. That's the easiest one to trade because you'll have to see it go up. If you trade up, it's going higher, and then it rolls over. Once that happens, you want to sell the first return back to a bearish order block. That comes in way of, the opening comes in 76.97. The high comes in at 76.97. That's where your short would be. Okay, once you get that, you put your stop above what we consider the bull flag's high. That way, that'll be your risk. So in terms of risking, a lot of it's not much at all, and you just wait for it to come back down to trade and close in perspective before the liquidity void that the bull flag creates, or the false flag that it creates. We've got the 15-minute time frame. You see, even on this time frame, we have the last up candle right first to start trading lower. The opening on that candle is 76.97 against the low as well, and obviously you've already shown the high is 7.97 here on this candle here. So price breaks down, closes in, it's void, the bearish order block, and then we see that sell off. Okay, so what am I showing here? I'm showing you that there's going to be times when we break our market down from top down perspective by defining the market in terms of discount or premium. Okay, and that's the entire time frame, as we show in the daily chart here, and walking our way down to a lower time frame that we can actually on. we can use the premise that other traders are going to see this as a bullish scenario. So it's really a sentiment play in addition to institutional overflow in our time frame. So we're able to see what everyone else with a retail-minded perspective would see here in terms of continuing on the upside. But when we start to see it right now, we know we can get back in here and sell short right at that moment there. And then quickly price moves away aggressively and closes in. It's wood right here. And also trade one more time, closing in a smaller liquidity wood here. And also moving lower. So take a look at an example of a bear flag. That would be a false flag, and how that would translate into high prices.
Before I do continue, I do want to backtrack a tad bit. So like I pointed out, he used a swing high down a swing low, notice prices and premium, and if prices and premium, price is more likely to drop rather than rise. We also noticed the higher time frame bearish engulfing order block that price tapped into. We also noticed how price closed in premium, and he's also pointing out the liquidity voids in this area. Specifically, from this low to this high, there's a void, and then from this high to this low, there's another void there. So it gives a reason why price will want to at least come up to this area and then give a reaction. I'm assuming later on in the course, he might talk a little bit more about order flow, because here he's pointing out how price came up here to tap this low before pushing on lower. But even after that, we have a small little fair value gap here that he is pointing out. I'm not too sure why this one is so important, why a different one is not important. Why are we not using this high to this low here? Is it because price already mitigated this area and then dropped? But at the same time, how come liquidity above here can't be considered as a potential area that price will want to sweep before going on lower? There's just several questions that I have regarding this specific price action. So I'm just pointing out where my questions are and trying to figure those out in the moment. I am assuming, though, since this is still just month two, we will dive deeper later on in the course. But for now, I'm just pointing it out. So I'm not too sure exactly why he marked up this specific area and was so detailed or so honed in on this area and watched price react in that area. But nonetheless, what he's mainly showing us here is that we need to understand the higher time frame objective. We need to understand where price is relative to the higher time frame to understand what price is more likely to do. Because once again, if we see this and just think, oh, bullish bear, bullish flag, I'm going to long, you can see how price would have stopped us out here. He also does point out that once you see that price is showing signs to go lower, we see this low gets broken and then price pushes back on up to mitigate this order block, this buy to sell move. Price taps in here. I think he pointed out the open of the candle somewhere in here. He's looking at the values in the upper left-hand corner. Price comes up, gets very close to that exact same price point and pushes on lower. But to make it very simple, we see price goes up before it goes lower. So this would be a bearish order block. And then price comes in, taps it, mitigates it, and then pushes on lower. So this could have been an opportunity for us to take shorts with a stop loss above one of these highs. And as you can see, it would be a relatively tight stop loss, giving us a big RR potential play.
On the low end, that's where it would look like that comes in way of first come back down, breaks down, closes in 61. That moment, there, sudden climb, we're in existing downtrend here. Okay. So take a look at an example of a bear flag, that would be a false flag, and how that would translate into higher prices. Okay, we have one more example here. Price is a sudden climb, we're in existing downtrend here. Okay. Price is a small consolidation, we're having that small consolidation slightly higher. Okay, by all intents and purposes, this would be deemed as a classic bear pattern. Okay, or bear flag. A continuation. So one would reasonably expect to see a move from this high down this low, from this high, particularly lower. So we could potentially see a move. About 73.55 if we were looking at pure chart patterns in form of classic patterns. The problem is, the market's trading down into 74.42, so what's going to be about that? Okay, well, I'm going to show you by having our higher time frame perspective. We're going to highlight this area. Okay, that's where our bear flag is, or our pseudo bear flag. And I want you to see what's actually happening here. The market's trading to that level, we're going to have a higher time frame, I want you to see what happens. Right from price at this point here. Suddenly that bear flag doesn't look so bearish. Okay, so by having this, let's go here and take a look at the daily chart. Okay, here's that area where that bear flag would go up here, like we just showed on the line chart. Look at the bodies of the candles over here. Okay, all these wicks trading down here. Again, all the heaviest volumes inside of the wicks. So if we take our area, we highlighted, keep the word anchored at for the line chart, so we're identifying as a false bear flag. I'm actually identifying all the price action below these lows. Okay, I'm not using the wicks, I'm using the bodies of the candles. Okay, and the expectation is this movement here, because we're now coming back down into this area for the first time in a couple months, 1 month and a half here, only Aussie. So we're going one more time back into this area below the lows in terms of their bodies, of the candles, not the wicks. Okay, so we ignore all these wicks. We know that all of the volume is seen in the bodies. So this run down below here, we're really just making a run more time for the stops below these candles. So we're seeing it on the daily chart. We have to consider that move back into the hourly chart. So when the market starts seeing a pseudo bear flag in here, we don't see that as a bear flag. We actually start going in and looking for reasons to expect higher prices. Now we don't see people buy it. As the market starts to rally, we might wait for some high to be created and violate on the upside. Okay, we get that here, some high. Market trades up through here, comes back down to the last bearish candle right here. So we can take that idea and not look at it as a bear flag, but look at it as a buying opportunity. So we could be a buy right here with a stop below the flag low. So we'd be doing this. You stop below there. You're getting long at 74.70. We'll call it 74.70. And the expectation would be we'll be looking for a range fill in of all these down candles. So we look for upside objective here, last candle body. And then we'll be looking for the stops above these equal highs, that clean level here. Plus we have another.
This year, I'm showing my mom I'm investing in health and happiness by giving her the gift of a lifetime. With
Whoop, she'll be able to... There's a block here, and one more right in here. And then we'll equal highs again, so we'll be looking for that, for a liquidity pool. and we look up here for another objective we want to look for a really long-term type scenario. Okay, so going forward, price responds off that level rather handsomely. Comes back with a retracement, just to populate more buying in here. Price comes up, sweeps out, these equal highs right here. So these highs in here, we're clearly out the high on this candle. Comes in at 75.68. The high on this candle here comes in at 75.73, so clearly stops out here. So it's a little rejection here. And ultimately, we see price right up into closing this range here, and going through this high, and then the next area liquidity is pretty cool here. It trades through that here. It's all consolidation again, and ultimately seeing that run up into that rejection here. So it's a bearish support that, and it's up for that as well. And ultimately, so we measure clear out the old highs right here. Okay, so it's not the fact that we're looking for chart patterns, okay, and especially if the idea of looking for a continuation mindset by this roller didn't realize we have one here. Okay, price trade down, creates a small consolidation, slightly higher, it'll be as well. Okay, but we're actually going to do a for swing high, be violated, okay, and we have a swing high here. Even though it's a lower level, we're going to look like, oh, it's going to keep going lower, also, it's going to higher. And a swing high violated there. So we have the last down candle right here, go down time, there it is, there's your buy. And you're going higher. Prior to the down move, you just identified, verified that it was suspect. Okay, it's a false verified. So when I look at price action, this is my biggest takeaway. When I'm looking at price action, I'm looking for reasons why other traders will view the opposite side of the marketplace. So I'm not always looking for what would make me take the trade. I'm also looking for the marketplace to suggest to me how retail-minded traders are going to view things in the form of classic chart patterns, in the form of indicators. And we'll talk about that later on in this mentorship. But for now, I want you to take away the study of going back through all data, go through charts, and find areas where bear flags and bull flags were basically looking as if it would call for a lower price for bear flag and a reverse minimum, and look for opportunities where the market showed a clear example of what would be viewed as a bull flag, but it creates a high. And what happens actually is this: the market goes into a period after it rallies up or it moves down for a period of time. If we have the market create a run up. Okay, so it creates a quick rally up. Then, after that rally, the market will go into an consolidation. Okay, think about it now. Price delivery has been rapid on one side of the marketplace. So the market will go into consolidation and call for a couple periods. And that period is going to be relative to what it needs to do. You never know exactly how long that time period is, which, again, we don't care. There's no weak indications. The market's going to reach a specific level of liquidity above the marketplace. So if you get that big run up and start consolidating, and consolidating slightly lower in value, whatever class bull flag would be, what's actually happening is they rally price up, the trader's thinking what? It's going to keep going higher. And they pause it. What many times you'll see is the market will just do this. Just make a slightly short-term higher high, and then collapse. This is the basis of turtle soup. And you see that here. Okay, we have consolidation here. Price rises up and then it falls through. Okay, the scenario is seen here. Price drops down, consolidates, it drops lower, so this will be like this. Okay, that would be a decline, consolidation. The initial leg lower, just by a little bit, the short term of violating these lows right here. So when you see that, it's going to look like it's validated for the bear flag to go lower and have projected measure move lower. But in fact, all it's doing is taking out the short term lows here and then reversing and running away, which is again the basis of the turtle soup. Bye, and you see that taking place right here.
Before we do continue, I want to backtrack once again to see exactly what he said in this area. Just let me find it real quick.
4 months and a half here on the Aussie. So we're going one more time back in this area below the lows in terms of their bodies. Okay, it's not the wicks. Okay, so we ignore all these wicks. We know the bulk of the volume is seen in the bodies. So this run down below here, a couple months, 4 months and a half here on the Aussie. So we're going one more time back in this area below the lows in terms of their bodies. Okay, it's not the wicks. Okay, so we ignore all these wicks. We know the bulk of the volume is seen in the bodies. So this run down below here, we're really just making one more time for the stops below these candles. So we're seeing that on the daily chart.
All right, so as you can see here, he specifically states that price is coming back down here to get underneath these wick lows for some more stops. For the stops below these candles. To be honest, I'm a little confused here because price already wicked out or took out these lows with this big bearish candle. So I'm not too sure why he is considering there to still potentially be sell stops underneath these lows. It doesn't really make sense to me. Price already took out these lows based off that wick. If anything, my interpretation is price wicked these lows, taking out these lows, which is the manipulation phase, in this case within accumulation, and there is going to be old orders resting in here, and price is simply mitigating an order block down here. But nonetheless, maybe I'll get more clarification as the course continues, but price comes down here. This is a higher time frame key area. So even though on the lower time frames, this may look like a bearish flag or a continuation pattern, price actually reverses, and the reason is because we are in that higher time frame key area. So once again, always keep in mind the higher time frame and what price is doing on the lower time frame relative to the higher time frame to give you a better understanding of what price is most likely going to do. Because if you're just simply looking at one time frame, you'll find yourself in the opposite direction or in the wrong direction, as you can see here. Continuing forward, I notice as he's showing that price is anticipated to go bullish, he's marking up some potential areas. You can see the way he marks up these levels. He's marking up the candle open, this last bullish move before price close. My question is, on this time frame, on the 1 hour, yes, this is the opening of the candle. But if you use the 4 hour, this candle open will probably be down here. So how does he know to use this specific time frame and not another? Or is he just simply giving a general idea or area where price may be going? Here he points out liquidity. How come he didn't point out the candle open here before a close? He definitely did it here. And then as we continue moving it on,
bearish order block here, and then one more in here.
There's one more there.
Again, so we look for that. For
so he pointed out liquidity here. but Acme's not pointing out liquidity above this high or even above this high. I'm not too sure exactly why he's deciding to point out these specific areas, but not others. Again, it might just be he's just giving a general overview of what to look for or what is most prominent maybe, but I'm not too sure. But just something that I did notice at the time.
And we look up here for another jacket forward. Price down here in the position again, and ultimately, and it's here. Okay, price trade down, creates a small consolidation, slightly higher.
Also here, let's take a look at this.
Is what? A butterfly. Okay, what we're actually going to do there, to down to the last down, suspect. Okay, it's a false butterfly. So when I look at price action, this is what I'm going to get this takeaway. There's your buy. Higher. And what's going to high there, to down to the last down candle over here. Try that on time. There it is. There's your buy.
So here he points out how price took out these lows. This is the last down move before price went higher. He draws out, or doesn't really draw it out, but he shows him drawing an imaginary line outwards to draw the order block, and that's where price taps into. But if you notice, going back to the higher time frame here, where was it? Here, he's not drawing an order block. He's just saying, oh, price is coming down here to take out old wicks. But in my interpretation, this wick down, taking out the sell side liquidity, there is an order block resting this area. But then if you go back over here, he's not doing the exact same tactic here. He's actually showing where the wicks got stopped out, where we had the manipulation move to the downside, taking out sell side liquidity, drew an order block, and then seeing price tap into this order block. He's not using the exact same thing that he said on the higher time frame. Again, I'm not sure if I'm just not up to par with what he is saying, or I'm just not interpreting it the exact same way. But as I stated, hopefully later on in the course, things will clear up a little bit. But I'm just pointing out what I'm seeing right now here in the moment.
Identify, verify that it was a suspect. Or what would mean, if I'm here, is where verify, if you have the market create a period going relative to what it needs to do. The rally price up, the trader's thinking what? It's going to go higher. And he calls it. What many times you'll see is the market will just higher high, rise up, and then it falls through. Okay.
I did want to point this out too. Keep in mind where he shows the turtle soup buy move. For example, actually he hasn't gone over the buy yet, he's going over the short. But here, turtle soup sell. Price takes out the buy sell liquidity. A lot of people might think this is a bullish continuation flag. Get that pull to the upside. Sideways movement. Doesn't really angle downwards, but nonetheless, it's still sideways. We get that big push to the upside, thinking that price is going to continue to go higher. But then it collapses, as he shows here in his diagram, and pushes on lower. And then over here, he shows the turtle soup buy, where we have that down move to the downside, sweeping out the lows, and then reverses to the upside, to the exact same thing but flipped. One thing to point out, I'm curious to know if he'll talk about it in the future. You notice here we have that sweep to the downside, and then price actually pulls back into discount, tapping in that order block. Here, price sweeps to the upside, but we never really get much of a pullback. If in a perfect world, we would use swing high to swing low, price would come up to here, up into premium, maybe at the very least tag this low. But if you notice, price doesn't even tag this low. So I'm curious to know if he does have a way of understanding if price will or will not come down into discount or up into premium. And if he understands that price isn't going to come up into premium, such as here, how does he know to take shorts down here in discount rather than allowing price to pull back on up and take a short in premium? But other than that, let's go on to the next video.
And reversing. And running away, which is again, the base of the turtle soup. Buy. And you see that taking place right here. Okay, folks, welcome back. This is the 8th and final teaching for the second month of the IT mentorship. This is the month of October. We're dealing specifically with market maker traps of false breakouts. And we're talking about specifically in this teaching, one side of the marketplace, just for the sake of saving time, everything that we show you will be through a reverse side of the mentorship. So false breakout above price consolidation. This condition generally manifests in primary bearish markets. In other words, the market's in a downtrend or presently trading lower or expected to trade lower. A false breakout above the consolidation is reasonably expected, and generally what you see manifest itself. At some measure of equilibrium price, the market will move into a trading range. Neophyte traders, this Black Friday, my value membership is 50% off for life, and when you get my value membership, traders or breakout traders will bracket the trading range in price with orders. That means they don't have buy stops to break out and buy above with orders. That means neophyte traders or breakout traders will bracket the trading range in price with orders. That means they don't have buy stops to break out and buy above the old highs or sell stops below the old lows to sell short a break below the old lows in order to try to capture a trend. And they're going to buy above the marketplace and sell below the marketplace because they absolutely have no idea what's going on. Or breakout traders, they just want to bracket the marketplace like long-term trend followers. They don't mind taking a lot of losses with the hopes of eventually catching a large trade. The market makers will typically send price above the range to neutralize buy stops. So they're going to focus primarily on one side of the marketplace. And again, assuming the market is primarily bearish, that's what the market makers know is going to be. Their playbook is to run the buy stops above the marketplace. Now, false breakout below price consolidations is obviously the opposite. This condition generally manifests itself primarily in bullish markets. At some measure of equilibrium price, the market will move into a trading range. Neophyte traders and or breakout traders again will bracket the trading range in price with orders. Again, looking to focus on buying or breakout, showing breakout, they're not pretty or astute enough to know what direction they simply react to where the market gives them in terms of breaking above or below. But the market makers will typically send price below the range to neutralize the sell stops.
So some traders are simple breakout traders. Most of the time, breakout traders will see a range, and the moment they see price break to the upside, they are looking to capitalize, or they anticipate price to continue to move to the upside, so they try to capitalize on that move. Same thing when price breaks to the downside, they assume price is going to continue to the downside, so they take shorts, believing or wanting to capitalize on that bearish move. But I'm assuming here he's going to show us how that is not the proper way of looking at the markets and how we should be looking at it specifically from a bank perspective.
Below the range to neutralize the sell stops. So graphically, what I'll show you here is a breakout trader or a new venture's perspective when the market goes into a trading range. Above the old high, for recent high, they'll have buy stops for long breakout traders. And anyone that must be short, obviously, their buy stop will be resting above the high. And below the lows, there will be sell stops for long traders and sell stops for short breakout traders. In order to capture a move that will hopefully continue going for a long period of time lower, they would like to get short on weakness. And obviously, bulls might be on the breakout traders, only buying on strength, they think, by breaking out above an old high, they have their buy stop to trend into a long position, and the belief is that they're going to hopefully capture a long-term trend up. Now, from a market maker perspective, we look below the marketplace when we have lows in form of sell stops. Now, we're focused primarily on a buying environment, okay, focusing on when the market is underlying bullish. Everything that I show you here would just be reversed for when the market is bearish, okay, so it's a safe time. When the market breaks below the consolidation, those sell stops are used to pair long orders. Now, who's buying those sell stops is smart money. But what types of orders rest above here? If you know below the marketplace, sell stops, but it's resting above the highs, buy stops. So naturally, as the market moves away from those sell stops being right now, below the consolidation, they're going to expand price, think of it now, they're going to expand price up to liquidity above the high. So those buy stops are going to be used to pair long selling, and we're going to scale out long positions or take some profits. Eventually, the market will go into an area of consolidation or no trading range. The market drops below the trading range, they take out the sell stops below consolidation. Now, as soon as this happens, your thought process should internally be going on inside your mind, okay? They've already shown willing to take sell stops below 108.55. Now they rally price above the 109-day figure. We've retraced a little bit, okay? So if they are taking the market below this short-term consolidation, they're probably going to run the price higher. So where would those objectives be? What's resting above that old high? Buy stops. So if they're taking the market below a consolidation, and our understanding of our expectations is the market is bullish, they're taking the market below consolidations to run sell stops out. The only reason why they want to do that is to absorb their sell stops to be counterparties for their longs. When they're long, when they're long, how do they look to exit their positions and book a profit or hedge? They have to get out in a place where there's willing participants to buy. Buyers are always above the highs, even in the form of buying breakout or buy stops on short positions. That's what the liquidity is. Remember that market paradigm shift that's been spoken about in this membership? Well, we're talking about here again, just using in terms where you can see how it's applicable in price. Price runs above that old high, and now we have two areas in which the market has booked long positions. So now they're pricing in a buy model. So as the market moves higher, okay, they're going to liquidate some of their positions to hedge, and they're also going to liquidate positions that those traders don't think about or actually expecting a profit. So this is how they take their trades in point one, and they see them where they're placing their entries and where they're placing their orders to get out with profit. But what's over here? What rest above that? Remember, I showed you in the first month of this membership in September. Specific things to look for: clean highs, and clean lows. So there's an area right here that have clean highs. But above what we're showing right now, after that 109.15 level hit, there really isn't much in way of liquidity voids or pools. There'll be much interest, except for those stops above these highs. As you see, price expands. Think now in the interbank price liquidity algorithm, it's going to expand up into liquidity. That's what we see here. Then what happens? Price and variable goes, we'll go back into consolidation. Now, what's the underlying condition of the marketplace? It's bullish. Why? Because it's keeping price below and then rejecting that, absorbing the sell stops and expanding price higher. Is there any reason to suspect that price will go higher? Look at the price actions here. You see anything that jumps off at you? It doesn't. We'll come to it as we move forward in this example. We have consolidation here. Our reasonable expectation would be to see price seek the sell stops below consolidation. Price does in fact go below consolidation. What's above this old high? Liquidity. Now, do we always look at the old high, or what do we look for? Do we consider the wicks? We can. But primarily, all the volume is seen in what? The wicks of the bodies. The bodies of the candles. So the body of the candles has the most volume, so the liquidity is going to rest above it. So if you have the stops out below the 108.95, you're going to look to run price higher in the form of 109.40 or higher. But initially, we have that short-term consolidation. The buy stops are pressing above that. They scale off position right there. And the next objective.
Before we continue, I want to break down a couple things. Here, we have price in a relatively consolidated phase. I say relatively because price isn't making a very clean box. We have relative equal lows down here and then somewhat relative equal highs. Keep in mind, consolidation doesn't always have to be picture perfect like we see in a line chart. Price can do something like this, which is a little bit more realistic. But nonetheless, we can see price is moving sideways. Here, there are going to be sell stops underneath these lows. Why? Because people are looking to long at this level of support or level of demand, either or. People are looking to long. If they are longing, where are they putting their stop loss? It is going to be underneath these lows. What are stop losses? Well, they are sell stops. So when price comes down here, what happens is all the traders that were looking to long get stopped out, also known as their sell stops get triggered. And the banks are able to use those sell orders to pair their buy orders and push price on higher. Up here, people are looking to short. If they are shorting, where are their stop losses? Above the highs. If their stop loss is above, what exactly kind of order is that? That is going to be a buy stop. So there are buy orders resting above here. As price pushes on up, triggers those stop losses or buy stops, it dumps a bunch of buy orders in the market. And guess what? If the banks are looking to take profit off of their buy orders, they need to go ahead and sell some of those orders so they can take profits. Well, they are able to sell those orders because there are buy orders resting above this high. So they are able to pair their short orders with the buy orders and take profits. And the process continues to repeat. We have sell liquidity resting underneath these lows. The banks take out the liquidity. Now there are a bunch of sell orders resting in the market. They're able to pair those sell orders with their buy orders and push price on higher. Also, we understand that the banks are pushing price on higher. So as price comes on lower, it makes sense that they will want to continue to push the price higher, not only because there is sell side liquidity resting underneath these lows,
but also because we can see price is intending to push price on higher. Same thing here, we have consolidation. Do we anticipate price to reverse and go bearish? It sure could if the banks really want to, but realistically, what is more likely going to happen? Well, they've already been pushing price on higher, so they're looking to simply take out sell side liquidity and push on higher. At the same time, we can see price takes out this high, gives a reversal. The banks are able to take profits. Same thing here, price comes above, and we do take out these highs over here before pushing on lower. The banks are taking profits right here. I will note that if you notice, why doesn't ICT point out why price didn't fall down from here? Even from this old high, if we drag a line all the way out, we even have some form of a one top, two top, double top pattern. Why doesn't price fall from here? We even have a clean high right here. Price kind of rejects but doesn't fall from here, but price decides to fall from all of these equal highs here. So I'm just pointing out, I'm not sure exactly how we can distinguish that price will fall from this high over here, but not this high or this high or this high. Not too sure. Maybe he'll explain in the future, but just one thing to point out. And I will also point out that he's using the body of the candle because this represents the most volume liquidity above it. To be honest, I have never done this. Mainly one, because on a different time frame, the candle closure will be somewhere different. So right now we're on the M15, so this is the M15 closure. But if I go to the M30, it might be a tad bit higher or lower. If I go to the H1, it might be higher or lower. So how do I know which time frame to use? What is consistent on all time frames is the wick high. So not too sure how he distinguishes which time frame to use. Also, looking back over here, I'm pretty sure he's going to use the wick high, not the candlestick closure. Even looking over here, in this case is not anything different because they're relative in the same area, but the whole point is I'm not sure if in this high here he's going to use the candlestick closure or the high. In this case, he decides to use the high, but I'm not too sure how he is deciding to use it. Yes, he does claim that this is where the most volume is, but like I said, it is going to be different on every single time frame. So just something to point out, and maybe I will get some clarity as we continue on in the course.
It would be Y940. As you see, Y940 is swept, moving just above the lights of the candles. Note the way that orders are stacking higher each time they buy a little higher, each time they're working their orders in, and still offering opportunity to scale off and profit. So the hedgers can work this model, the speculators at the bank level can work this model, and also provide liquidity for those individuals that want sell stops to be activated if the market goes down to their positions, and those individuals that want buy stops above the old highs, they're happy because the liquidity is being provided as well. So think, remember that market 50 paradigm? You have to think like a market maker. Now we have a larger trading range. Now I kept that area, but so buying was done at 1.95. But now we move into a larger range. Nothing changed here. The model is still bullish. So we see market action trade below that consolidation. We trade down to 1.85. So with that movement down into that level, where is the liquidity at? Above the old high at 1.945 or so. That's what you have here. So what is it specifically? Buy stocks. So we have willing buyers that are waiting up there for price. Once it gets there, they're buying normally buying at 1.089 or 1.85 in that area. And they know there's only one participant to be buying it from them when they want to sell for profit at 1.945 to 1.950. So 1.945 to 1.950 is hit. So the buy stocks are used to carry long excess. So now we have a wonderful example of how using consolidations with the expectation of viewing the market with that market 50 paradigm I spoke about, where we think like a liquidity provider. We can still speculate, we can still hedge, we can still make a profit. Using the same model, it answers all of the problems.
So this one, this is a bit of a stretch for me personally. This range here, yes, it is a range, but I wouldn't consider it as a consolidation range. If you're just plotting up this high to low, yes, any high to low or low to high will be a range. But this isn't really a consolidation range, so I'm not too sure if he's going to consider this as a consolidation range. Or he's just saying range in general. If you notice, this candlestick closure coincidentally lines up with price pushing back on lower. Once again, this candlestick closure will look different on a different time frame. So I don't know exactly how he knows to use this specific time frame. Also, yes, price is taking out liquidity down here. There are equal lows resting down here. Even with a bullish trend line here, price is taking out liquidity. So yeah, it makes sense. Sell side liquidity is swept before pushing on higher. I am just questioning how he knew that price would reverse from this candlestick closure rather than attacking the high and then going lower. And as price went lower, as you know, price is going to now run above the high and not, you know, tap a candlestick closure and not invalidate the high or breach the high and then push on lower. So those are just my comments so far.
relates to trading, but specifically it offers the answer to liquidity providing. Buy stops are activated and they're actually given the ability to be effective and sell stops the same way. So what the market makers do, we can vilify them and say, oh, those rascals stated this to me, that to me. Okay, but what they're doing is their job, they're providing liquidity. The absence or lack of understanding that traders have, they attribute that as those guys, they did it and they use to misappropriate that to the broker. But what it is the market maker is providing liquidity. And if you understand how the market seeks liquidity, that's the number one driver in price action. The market will always seek liquidity. And where is the most recent area of liquidity that's been untapped with the least of resistance gained to it? And that will give you the directional bias when you're a trader. But when you see market consolidation and you have an underlying directional premise, or you arrive at one based on studying market like this, you can quickly ascertain trade setups and signals will jump off the chart at you by way of looking at this. Again, we have to look at price with that market efficiency paradigm. We do not look at it as give me a buy and sell. Okay, think like the market maker. You have complete control of price. Where would you buy price to allow other traders to gain and at least facilitate trading? At least, whatever wrong, it's not the problem. Where's the buyer to sell that? And if you look at the market in this perspective, we'll know that we'll always have to buy and we'll always have to low lows. So if you know that's where liquidity rests. All you have to do is determine whether or not does the market want to seek the buyers or does it want to seek the sellers. And the way you get that indication is by saying when they go into consolidation, what's the market reaching for? And then where's the market going to happen? And here you can see every time consolidation, the market seeks liquidity below the marketplace. And what's the doors that equal to the other direction? Why is that happening? Because the market makers are still in the wrong positions and build a buy and buy in price for an asset. So we expect to see every time the market goes below, these consolidations, these movements below are always going to be viewed in our eyes as a false breakout. So false breakout, if it trips up traders, otherwise we're not in our proper positions, because they've been ringing long. We can view the marketplace with the market security on, seeing as a provider of liquidity, seeing as distancing, so the market does, and we're suddenly in line with the market, being market around trying to outsmart the market, all trying to do in line with their motive. So how are we going to do with the market for this particular day, for this month, for this week? Okay, how are we going to do that? And by looking at models that we're showing here, looking at ranges and the break below the ranges, and seeing when there's a rally after that, if you first step to the consolidation, expect every drop down below an old area of consolidation, expect the false breakout, and then accumulation of positions in the market, once they catch the consolidation, then they will be priced, the market higher, running by stops at all times. What else do you see here? You're doing this, what else do you want to study this from a magic balls video, study this for a few minutes, and see if anything stops right. And this is what I'll show you is it, what's there. This first price point from the first initial false breakout below the lows and consolidation, once I rally up, and we have another area where you buy again at that 175 level, the red area, if you will, I guess it's red, it's a measure move from that same buy, and it gives you an approximation of where the algorithm will reach for to offer price. And we see it at that 1925 level from 1875, which is the measure move from the initial low that ran up and create that first red box in the first impulse price line. The second leg in price higher is equal to that first one. Also, the larger price line from that first initial buy all the way to the intermediate term high or the midpoint of the overall price line. Once we had that large consolidation, it went down and traded into 1885. When that happened, that same measure move from 10850 up to 10945 thereabouts, that same measure move from the stop run at 10885, that gives us a projected run up to that 10980 level. And you see that was handsomely hit. And ultimately, that 109 as we spoke in real time at the time of this recording in membership, which we spoke about that 109 level, meaning directly links to the actual bottom of the chart. And all these things coalesce, they start coming together, they dovetail beautifully. But understanding each individual component will help us bridge that they dovetail beautifully. But understanding each individual component will help us to that 109 level.
Before I continue, before he showed the ranges here, he's just talking about liquidity. Ultimately, we need to understand where liquidity rise, the price or the algorithm is looking to seek out liquidity. So it isn't something to do with your broker out to get you, trying to take you out and move price in the anticipated direction and things like that. It is simply the algorithm designed to take out liquidity. So when you understand where liquidity lies and how the algorithm is programmed, you have a better understanding of what price is going to do. And then here he's plotting the ranges. When you have a range, you can kind of anticipate the second push to be relatively the same push here. So here, I'm not sure if he states exactly how many pips this is. But if you notice, this first push up here is relatively similar to the second push there. He's also pointing out, in this case, from this swing low to swing high, price actually gives a relatively similar push from this low to this high as well. Personally, I've never used this in the sense of like really trusting a move is going to happen the exact same way as the previous move. But maybe this is something that I can look a little bit deeper into. I know some people use another form of anticipating how far a move will go based off of standard deviations, which I'm sure he will go over later in the course. But the whole point I'm trying to bring up is you don't need to look at it like this, especially sometimes it can be subjective, such as why am I not using this swing low to swing high, but I'm using this low to this high? Well, how come I can't go further back and use a lower low to a higher high and then drag that range out? It gets a little confusing because you can, like I said, drag it from any low to any high. And yeah, just kind of confusing when it's subjective like that. But if you have some way of using it, me personally, for example, if I'm going to strictly plot out structure from a structure low to structure high, maybe I can anticipate the next move to be the exact same push. But I know it is not always going to be like this, but it could be some way to help you out to figure out where price is more likely going to go. But ultimately, I would just be looking left, find liquidity, and look at those areas to target as a first priority, and then maybe use this strategy if you'd like. And then continuing here, he said that this was a daily order block. I'm going to listen again.
To that 109 level, you see how it can get. And I'll tell you that 109 level, in real time, because I'm recording the membership, I'll tell you that 109 level, I mean, directly to the chart, and all these things.
So he's saying this is a bearish order block on the daily chart. Oh, wait, yeah. He did point out this here. I'm assuming this red line is like the medium, I think he called it the mean threshold, which is the 50% of this candle. At first, I thought he was plotting this as the order block, which I was going to somewhat disagree with. But here he's plotting the last buy to sell move here. This is a little funky because this wick high takes out this wick before pushing on lower. So honestly, me personally, would go down to a lower time frame and plot an order block within here. And then price is tapping into this one. So maybe I will get some clarification on what he distinguishes as an order block. Because what throws it off for me is this wick that took out this high. If this wick wasn't here, I would be perfectly fine with calling this an order block. But it's just this wick here is a little funky. But if anything, I would interpret this as a bearish engulfing order block variation, which just means that it isn't a simple, nice two candlestick pattern. We have the nice bullish and then a nice bearish engulfing candle. This one takes 1, 2, 3 candles, even though the wick got above here. And then we got the engulfing here. So either way, this is the last buy move, and it took 3 days for price to close underneath the candle open, still giving it the classification of a bearish order block, but we'll see. All right, that is it for today, for day 3 of the ICT speedrun. If you guys enjoyed the video, please hit that like button. If you have any comments, questions, concerns, drop them down below or join the free Discord as well. As always, I will be doing notes for you guys that will come for you guys tomorrow. So check back in tomorrow for day 4. Thank you guys for watching, and I will catch you in the next one.